When the lights come on, the brightest stars shine. Best 2 out of 3, a spot in the finals on the line. It's the NLL semis, and it doesn't get any better than this.
Rise up and take us to the top. We can't stop, no, we can't stop, no. Cause every step we take with our heart in the race, with each step we're closer now. Rise up,
on San Diego, California. Game one of the NLL semifinals. The 3-seed Albany Firewolves travel to play the 2-seed San Diego Seals. Through the quarterfinals and into the semis, Toronto, Buffalo, San Diego, and Albany, the final four. The winners will meet in the finals. Game one already complete between Toronto and Buffalo, with the Bandits posting a dominant win over the league's top seed. Hi, everybody. We welcome you inside the building at Pechanga Arena alongside the former Notre Dame star and NLL player Nick Acello. I'm Cooper Perkins. Thank you for spending your Friday night with us. And Nick, we have two fascinating storylines at work tonight. On one hand, San Diego trying to complete their redemption arc after some heartbreaking playoff losses. And Albany, the surprise of the league, has just won their way into this position.
Father Time playing a little bit dual role tonight, with San Diego being the oldest roster and Albany being the youngest. So we'll see if that experience or that youthful energy triumphs here tonight.
You mentioned that Albany youth. They're led by two great pieces, Alex Simmons, Ty Kurtz.
To come in as a rookie and be the pillar of an offense is certainly a feat in itself, but what's really impressed me is how they've grown, their IQ, their wits, and how they play alongside one another. You compare that to a guy like John Wagner, who put up a ridiculous stat line, a human Swiss Army knife who can do it all. Albany certainly has some great things to look forward to tonight, but if you look at the true X factor of what Albany is riding on, it's the performance of goaltender Doug Jamieson posting a stat line for the ages and one of the best performances we will see in the playoffs this year last week.
The numbers spoke for themselves. The second fewest goals allowed in a playoff game in league history with 3, 52 saves, and the second best save percentage in a game ever behind only Matt Vince. This time of year, the best goaltending has a habit of winning championships. The good news if you're San Diego is they have gotten some pretty good goaltending themselves. Chris Origliere now making just his second playoff start in his young career. It's not about the volume and the quantity of saves that he makes. It's about the kind and the difficulty.
And coming in, you never really know what kind of performance you're going to get from a first playoff appearance. But Origliere stood tall as Panther City got consistently good looks. It's his youthfulness, his athleticism, and his acrobatics that really allowed him to take over the game and send Panther City packing.
Offensively, some guys are just gamers. Austin Stotts and Dane Doby fit that label.
How do you game plan against physics? When Austin Stotts decides that he's going to score a goal, there's almost nothing that you can do to stop that. And what's interesting is he draws so much attention that any number of San Diego offensive players can be the beneficiary of that. Last week, it was Dane Doby who had a hat trick and the ultimate game winner in a thrilling matchup against Panther City. But what was really interesting was the silence on the right-handed side.
Wesley Berg and Curtis Dixon combined for 0 goals compared to the 7 from Stotts and Doby. We talked to Patrick Merrill this week. He said, you know, those guys don't tend to have a whole lot of back-to-back goose eggs.
And it's going to be really interesting seeing Berg and Dixon have 0 goals. Expect a big rebound from them tonight, because those are two guys that are almost impossible to contain.
Well, Austin Stotts led the way last week with 4 goals. He's live on the floor with our very own Rain Michaels.
Cooper, Austin, what did you see from yourself and the rest of your team last week that you want to see again here tonight?
I mean, just sticking to the game plan, right? We didn't get frustrated in any way. I mean, like, we just got to stick together and hopefully everything just falls in line.
And thinking back to your insane helmetless goal last week, where does that will to win come from for you?
I mean, it just starts with passion, right? If I didn't have passion, I probably wouldn't be here.
All right, thanks, Audie. Good luck. Guys?
Well, there's the head man for San Diego. Patrick Merrill told us this week that things are different. I'm staying out of the way. I trust my team. They feel good. We feel good. We think it's our time.
And And Glenn Clark on the other side at the helm of this franchise since 2015, the architect of one of the biggest turnaround stories in league history, an 8-game improvement year over year for the Albany Firewolves. They have earned every step along the way. Their youth and inexperience did not matter a week ago. Now into the semifinals. The Albany Firewolves travel to the San Diego Seals. Great matchup in the dot tonight. Trevor Baptiste and Joe Nardella, these two guys know each other very well.
Very well for a number of different years, so this is going to be a battle. And right off the first initial faceoff, we got whistles flying.
Well, we talked about them at the top of the show. The rookie duo of Alex Simmons and Ty Kurtz. They'll operate on the righty side. Ethan Walker kind of runs the show on the lefty side. Here's Walker. As the ball stripped away by Patrick Schume in San Diego, collects for their first possession.
And that's a good offensive shift that'll show you why Albany is so dangerous. They are buzzing every time they're out on the floor. So how do you combat that? You need to put a premium on defending the middle of the floor. When every offensive player is trying to get a piece, just take away the dangerous areas.
Doby lets one go, and it beats Jameson off the bat. Jameson didn't give up a goal for the final 16 minutes and 43 seconds last week at San Diego. Beats him 40 seconds in.
And Dane Doby's shot is so sneaky deceptive, and I feel like it's always ramped up in the playoffs as one of the most clutch performers in NLL history. As you see Jameson react to Doby's shot early on in the game, Doby loves going high and away, and he was selling that the entire time before bringing it back near side and low. Such a difficult shot to defend, and exactly what San Diego needed.
Just flashed on your screen there as 81 career playoff goals, the second most all-time. John Tavares, the head coach of Buffalo, and arguably the all-time great with 85 within striking distance for Stotts in this series, especially if it goes three games.
It's going to be interesting to see this face-off matchup as well, because the first two have been all-out scrums. There was a whistle on the first one, and that second one is just going to be a 50-50 loose ball. Both teams talked about how important that is before the game.
We apologize for a minor technical difficulty on our score bug. It is 1-0 San Diego, 13:40 to go in the opening quarter, just underway as Curtis Dixon whips one on net. And Jameson makes his first stop. Colton Watkinson up with it and racing up the floor.
One thing that Albany does a good job of is pushing in transition. Talking to head coach Patrick Merrill, he even called out that it's not necessarily the first two guys, but the second, third, and fourth that can come on with a full head of steam.
Here's Simmons. Second most points in a rookie season in league history. Only Jeff Teat has put up more. Longboat collects. Simmons gets one on net. Crazy stick skills on the doorstep by the rookie.
Good job by San Diego's defense for 99% of that possession, but when that ball goes ricocheting, you kind of have to collapse towards the crease trying to prevent that.
Scratches tonight, Albany, Jackson Reed, Nicholas Volkov, San Diego, Brody Merrill, and Jacob Dunbar. Now Stotts diving into the crease, trying to get one past his summer teammate, Doug Jameson, who he won a Man Cup with over the summer for the Six Nation Chiefs. Won a couple of Mentos together playing for the Six Nation Arrows under Patrick Merrill. Well, a lot of connections in this one. Penalty away from the ball as Origliere goes sprinting to the bench. But it will not matter as John Wagner collects it and play is stopped.
That's another thing that makes it so difficult to play against San Diego. They're so tenacious that they draw a lot of penalties.
Special teams is an interesting piece in this one. We'll get to that in just a second. Anthony Joakim sits down, 2 minutes for holding the stick. Albany is the rare team with a negative net special teams number to make the playoffs. -6. So when you add up all their power play goals, penalty kill goals allowed, shorties, either way, you get a number, and that number is your net special teams goals. Albany -6, San Diego at +13, and Albany with the league's worst penalty kill on the year, 15th. At 30%, but did go 4-for-5 last week. No reset of the shot clock, time running out, and Dixon Just has to deliver one into the corner and a good defensive shift for Albany.
And if there was a lesson to be learned from last week's Albany-Halifax game, Halifax taught us that it's very difficult to win the game when you are down a man for what seemed like every single second. So, again, talking to head coach Patrick Merrill, he said that we have to stay disciplined and stay out of the box.
Cam Holding gets his stick in the passing lane, and here come the Seals back the other way. Absolutely ripping on the power play down the stretch of the season. Last 12 games, including the quarterfinals, 59%, 32 for 54. We're just 48.5% the first seven games. So once they settled in, they scored more power play goals than anyone in the league this year. Now Doby up high, collected by LeClaire, fresh shot clock.
I attribute a lot of that to that success to outside shooting and clearing the way for the shooters as well.
10:52 to go in the first quarter. Stotts rips it up over the crossbar, and Berg not able to track it down. It'll be over and back. Albany ball, still 25 seconds on the power play, so the Firewolves can kill off the rest of it if they take care of the ball.
On both of Stotts' outside shot, he's gone for that top left corner, and it's been open both times, but he's missed the net, so we'll keep an eye on where he's placing those shots.
Final seconds of the penalty kill for Albany. Ty Kurtz feeding on the crease. Marshall Paulus was open. Cut Kellen LeClaire ball watching, and it is a successful PK for the Firewolves as Jokum comes out of the box.
Although on both shorthanded attempts when they tried to feed the middle, it was open. So San Diego lucky that they weren't able to connect and get a shot on net on either one of those off-ball cuts.
Curtis Dixon gets a screen, trying to flip it to Berg. They cannot connect. And behind the net, Zach Young, the rookie, retrieves it. Game one of the NLL semifinals, second time in 3 years San Diego has made it this far. For Albany, a 3-15 campaign a year ago, the surprise of the league, but every bit as deserving as any of the other final three teams. Here's Simmons trying to initiate. There was a little head fake, got his hands free for a second, chased around by Eli Gobrecht, but the shot clock set to run out. He's dispossessed. And Gobrecht with a lockdown shift.
Great
on
defense.
Alex Simmons.
And Simmons is a quick and shifty player. Gobrecht matching feet, unbelievable job.
So Dane Doby gets San Diego on the board first. Alex Simmons and the young Firewolves trying to get their feet beneath them. It's 1-0, 9:26 left in quarter number one.
GEICO can help when you're locked out with their easy app and 24/7 help.
Dad, you don't.
GEICO can help cover cars, homes, motorcycles, and even accordions.
Pretty liberating.
GEICO can help cover cars, homes, motorcycles, and even accordions.
Pretty liberating.
GEICO covers dead batteries with their easy app and 24/7 help.
You've reached the setup!
All set, guys. Oh.
Sure.
I bet your pickled peppers I did.
Whatever you need, from coverage to service, get more with GEICO.
Higher shipping rates may be the cost of doing business, but at what cost?
Turn shipping to your advantage with low-cost ground shipping from the United States Postal Service.
To nothing with 9:26 to go in the first quarter of game one of the NLL semifinals. Glenn Clark looking on as his Firewolf offense tries to get the ball rolling. Alex Simmons and Ty Kurtz have been the story of the league this year. Two rookie sensations, first round picks from a couple of years ago, and the two of them combining for 70 goals. Just a phenomenal campaign. You can't say enough about what the two of them did right out of the chutes.
Yeah, and if you're an Albany fan, you got to be excited for where these careers are heading as well. Talked about it at the open, but to come in and make such an immediate impact only speaks to the maturity and high IQ of both of those guys, expecting big performances in the series.
Austin Stotts whips one, Jameson there. Yeah, you know, coming into the season, Glenn Clark knew that they would be better than last year. and knew that this team was on a quality trajectory, but I think they're a bit ahead of schedule given their appearance in the semis. But a very welcome sight for fans in the capital region of New York. Marshall Paulus, acquired from Saskatchewan last year, off to Simmons, who steps in and buries up high. Oh man, Alex Simmons with a missile. Caught the defense napping and burns one over the shoulder of O'Riglieri.
And this is just a beautiful shot. You see him kind of try to hunt a little bit. Am I going to be dodging? Oh, I actually have some time and room. And that was as well placed of a shot as you will see. O'Riglieri was even in a good position here as we look at that view right there. My goodness. Over that left shoulder of O'Riglieri, had a tiny target to shoot at and absolutely snipes it. Alex Simmons, welcome to the semifinals.
There is not a shred of this moment is too big for us for these Albany rookies. You know, they have kind of a youthful irreverence about them that shows up in sequences like that where they're not afraid to just let it rip.
No, and you know, you think about the mindset of a rookie. You can let the moment overwhelm you, or I don't want to call it ignorance because it'd be an injustice, but you can kind of be ignorant to, hey, this moment is huge. Simmons just doesn't care and unloads one. Beautiful goal to get Albany their first of the game.
Dixon gets inside. Dixon tucks it past Jameson. Welcome back, Curtis Dixon, after a goose egg a week ago.
His first playoff goal this season, and it's a beauty. That jab step right there is one of the most lethal dodges in the entire NLL. Just a little whoop, goes right to the middle of the floor, and a beautiful finish as well. Anytime your momentum is taking you one way, and look at where the head of the stick, he comes back across towards his left shoulder and buries it over Jameson. Great individual effort by Curtis Dixon and a textbook Dixon goal to give San Diego the lead.
65 career playoff goals for Dixon, closing in on third place on the all-time list behind Gary Gates. They're in the halfway point in the first. 2-1 San Diego. You know, that Dixon goal total brings to mind an incredible statistic. After Alex Simmons netted his first of the night, Albany's entire lineup has 13 career playoff goals. San Diego has five players with 13 or more individual playoff goals. It just shows you the chasm between these teams in age and experience.
But Albany looks settled as they push transition here.
Tchaikovsky gets a good one on net. One of the more experienced players for Albany, Nick Tchaikovsky, in his sixth NLL season, playing his fifth career playoff game.
You can always tell how comfortable teams are in the first 5 minutes of the game. Albany's made crisp passes. They've executed on offense, gotten looks, and pushed transition. So no rookie curiosity getting the best of them.
Dixon cannot get it through as Wagner soaks one up out front. Blocked 17 shots in the regular season and two last week. Now here he comes motoring up the floor. Drops it off for Watkinson, and O'Riglieri shuts the five hole.
Boy, looks like Albany is really going to try and manufacture goals in transition. San Diego stood tall, but they are giving up look after look.
Stotts battling in the corner. Watkinson comes over to help out Tchaikovsky. And Stotts diving. Can't get out of the crease. It wouldn't have counted if it went.
But not for lack of effort. He looked like a little bit of an actual seal there, trying to flap his way out of the crease.
Albany trying to answer. Alex Simmons tied it at one a couple minutes ago. And then Curtis Dixon giving San Diego the lead back. Penalty away from the ball as Jameson goes towards the bench. And Albany will have a 6-on-5 for a couple of seconds here. Late man on is Ethan Walker. He steps in, finds Simmons. Shot clock about to run out. And O'Riglieri can't find it. Walker tucks it between his legs.
And you see the respect that San Diego has for the outside shooters of Albany as Simmons was getting ready to wind up. They were trying to close out that gap, but when Albany has an extra player, there's going to be somebody that's open. We talked about defending the middle of the floor. San Diego with a momentary lapse right there, which allows Walker to catch and bury. Great execution with the extra man coming from Albany right there. And I don't want to jinx it, but last week against Panther City, there was no team that got a two-goal lead. Every goal that was scored was to tie or to reclaim a lead, and we've started just the same.
Only the second time ever that's happened. Oddly enough, both of those games this year. We're tied at 2, 6:14 left in the opening quarter of Game 1 of the NLL Semifinals. Buffalo bested Toronto 12-4. On the road in Hamilton in Game 1 of the other series. So they'll have a chance to close things out on Sunday when they go back to Bandit Land. And the series will continue on Sunday in Albany at 3 o'clock Eastern time.
And what's interesting about this face-off matchup is nobody's been able to win it clean. It's turned into a 50-50 scrum almost every single time.
Simmons thinks about one early in the shot clock, passes it up. A nice screen out wide, and Gobrek swats it to Longboat, who's in the perfect position, but it's taken away by Kyle Rubish, the all-time playoff leader in cause turnovers.
Great defensive possession by San Diego right there, not only making it difficult on the perimeter with pressure, but when that ball was fed inside, great collapse, really making it difficult on Albany to find a lane to shoot.
Dobie sweeping across the middle, stripped by Nardella over the top. Under 10 seconds to shoot. Dixon looking for some help. Attacks Sturis. Steps in the crease. Good defensive shift by the Firewolves that time.
Good back-to-back defensive shifts. Both offenses struggling to get their hands free for a shot. Credit to the defensive units.
And that's a unit that really improved as the season went on. Doug Jamison was excellent from the get-go. The defense really tightened it up. Now Simmons down low, Origliere returns it away. Danny Logan trying to force the issue. The Danimal, as they call him.
Boy, he is a special player and always has the potential to be the X factor, whether it's causing a turnover, even had a two-goal performance earlier this year.
That was week 21 against Vancouver. Now Dobie hits the pipe.
Boy, and if you're an Albany fan, Dobie already has one as Trey LeClair shows his athleticism and takes a nasty shot into the boards, getting up a little slow.
Albany captain Colton Watkinson is going to head to the penalty box after that one. But that's what Trey LeClair brings to the table, athleticism and hustle. He made that happen and then drew a penalty.
Absolute freak athlete, and he's been causing havoc in between the lines in transition all year.
Albany penalty number 17, 2 minutes, legal body check. TV.
So San Diego will go to the power play for the second time when we come back. It is all even at two up at Pechanga Arena. 4:18 left in the opening quarter. It's just starting to get a little bit rough around these parts.
Ooh.
Geico can help when you're locked out with their easy app and 24/7 help.
Dad, you don't have to make this so tough on yourself. Geico can help us get into our locked car. See?
Yeah, but where's the fun of that? Maybe I'm just nostalgic for the good old days. Before we had Geico's great coverage and 24/7 help.
All set, guys.
Oh. Let's go again.
Whatever you need, from coverage to service, get more with Geico.
Our biggest challenge? Uncertainty. Hidden fees, surcharges, who knows what to expect?
Turn shipping to your advantage.
Keep it simple with clear upfront pricing.
With USPS Ground Advantage.
It might be love. It might be love.
It's how you pile on the love. Kingsford. It's how you do it.
Coach, how do you think continue to get your offense going early?
You know what? I like their spacing. I like the, you know, the opportunities we presented. I mean, obviously we got a bury on them, but I haven't mind our movement patterns and the way we've created space. So we just got to keep grinding through and getting the looks.
And I know it's early, but is this the kind of matchup you were expecting?
Yeah, I mean, they're a dangerous team offensively. We've got to manage their offense and try and capitalize on the offensive end.
Thanks, Coach. Good luck.
Yeah, thanks, man.
Second power play of the game for San Diego. Albany successfully killed off the first. They've killed off five of the last six in starting the playoffs as Dobie can't find the pass from LeClaire. And it caroms all the way to Patrick Kaschuk, who had a phenomenal breakout sophomore season for the Firewolves.
Good ball movement by San Diego right there. It could be Dane Dobie versus Jameson, which is going to be a matchup we're seeing all night. But a rare drop from Dobie, especially with how clutch he is in the playoffs.
Alex Simmons and Ethan Walker, the two for Albany, as they have not led in this game, but have not trailed by more than one. And it's over and back as Kurtz had his feet on the center line when he touched that pass.
Gotta say though, the shorthanded offensive unit, which is a bit of an oxymoron, really grinding and working hard for Albany. Even though they're a man down, they are consistently working hard and getting semi-quality looks given the circumstance.
Berg running the point with Stotts to his right, Dixon to his left. Here's Dixon, down low to LeClaire. Skips one over to Stotts, rips it up over the crossbar. No reset of the shot clock, 7 seconds. Stotts again, blocked by Wagner. And the shot clock expires.
Bit of a missed one-timer from Origlieri right there, but no skin off anybody's bones, and good job by Albany limiting Stotts' present early. It looks like they're almost okay by letting him shoot from the outside. He's struggling to find the net.
Just observing this Albany team right now, they don't look the slightest bit concerned by the pressure of the playoffs. These guys are ready to play.
And you heard Coach Clark talk about it earlier. There are some good things, even though they only have two goals and it's a tie game. They're getting pretty consistent looks. And I would say that those man-down looks, those short-handed, quote-unquote, offense, really represents the effort that they're bringing here tonight.
Final 6 seconds of the power play. Albany will be back to full strength momentarily, but LeClaire first. Turned away by Jameson on the doorstep.
Watch
and here's
out.
Watkinson out of the box. Mishandles and turned away at the doorstep by Origlieri. We talked about it at the top of the show with Origlieri. It's not about the number of saves, it's the type and the difficulty. Still unsettled is the Firewolves recognizing a chance to press the change.
Boy, Eli Gobrecht is really matching Simmons' feet well. Very impressive individual matchups from 25 in purple so far.
Walker right into the stick of Origlieri.
When Origlieri settling in, it's just so impressive to watch. Every time Albany gets a good look, you still have to remember that Origlieri makes the saves that you might not expect him to make with so much consistency that you can't chalk it up to being a fluke.
Dobie opened the game with 140 seconds in and now sails it into the seats. And Albany will have it with 75 seconds left in the opening quarter. Tied at two, but all things considered, a very impressive first quarter from Albany. Good offense, creating quality looks, and a couple of big penalty kills, turning away San Diego with an extra player.
And San Diego's defense, to their credit, is playing well. They are not making it easy by any means. This is just a great matchup so far. Two high-level teams going back and forth.
Stotts squaring one up, lets it fly, and Jameson on the shoulder as Dobie came up with it and put it in the net but stepped in the crease. Not much of a question about that one.
And as I continue to watch where Stotts' shots are placed, that one was near side high. His first time doing that tonight. His stick just isn't quite as dialed as we've seen. The placement just an inch or two off. And this is a game of inches.
Walker draws a penalty away from the ball, and it'll be 6-on-5 in the final 7 seconds of this possession. Closing seconds of the quarter. Kurtz with time and room. And a wrist save by Origlieri.
Time winding down in the quarter. Simmons turns it in. Sam Firth on the one-timer with 0.4 seconds left.
Great composure by Albany right there. That's their second goal on a delayed penalty, 6-on-5, and they used that sixth player beautifully.
Canceled by the goal.
And so the penalty will be canceled, but as we look at that goal, I thought that they had to get a shot off in that moment, but instead of rushing the shot, just a beautiful one-timer to Firth on the backside. And that type of composure just represents that, yes, they are the youngest team in the league, but tell them that because they are playing like veterans out there.
So for the first time in five quarters in this building to start the playoffs, we will not have a tie game. All four quarters ended in ties a week ago when Albany takes a 3-2 lead with 0.4 seconds left. And that does it for the opening 15. They might be the youngest team in the league, but they are not playing like the moment is too big. The Albany Firewolves, with a late goal, take the lead. The fireworks just starting in San Diego. We got plenty of lacrosse still to play.
GEICO can help cover cars, homes, motorcycles, and even accordions.
Pretty liberating knowing GEICO can help insure our car. And with our home insurance, your accordion, too.
We're not the only ones out here taking advantage of GEICO.
Smoke him, Edna.
GEICO can help when you're locked out with their easy app and 24/7 help.
Dad, you don't have to make this so tough on yourself. GEICO can help us get into our locked car. See?
Yeah, but where's the fun of that? Maybe I'm just nostalgic for the good old days.
Locked back to January 20th. Last meeting, these two teams met up at MVP Arena in Albany. The Firewolves came in unbeaten, but it was San Diego up early and often. Seals took a big lead. Austin Stotts put up four for the Seals. They were up 7-1 at one point, but the Firewolves ripped off five straight, including one for Nick Chaikowski. In the end, San Diego pulled away. Curtis Dixon scored his fourth on the way to a 14-7 Seals win. At no point in that game did the Firewolves lead. They lead after one quarter tonight. You know, you always look at matchups like that and you have to throw them away, right? Because teams grow, teams change. That was the seventh game of the season for Albany after starting 6-0. You have to think, though, they're excited about this draw, a chance to correct that wrong.
Yeah, talking to head coach Patrick Merrill, we were even asking about how much can you take away from a game that took place in January as it's early in mid-May. And he said some of the processes are the same, some of the systems are the same, but they've improved across the board. So don't expect San Diego to coast off of anything that happened in January, as evident by the Albany one-goal lead.
Five different goal scorers in this game. Alex Simmons, Ethan Walker, and Sam Firth in that order. Firth put one in the back of the net with 0.4 seconds left in the first quarter. Two of those three goals coming on 6-on-5 delayed penalty situations. Simmons up high, had a Riglieri beat but couldn't get it on net. Now Firth, little face dodge. Rubish comes over and gobbles him up.
Well, that's an impressive unit right there. The two righties, Danny Logan and Kyle Rubish. If I'm Albany, I'll take my chances on whatever side of the floor they're not on.
Stotts thinking about attacking Zach Young. Instead pulls it out and lets the full complement get on. Joined by Dobie, Govett, Berg, and Dixon. Here's Berg, plays a two-man game with Dixon. Feeds Dobie right back to his former Calgary teammate, Curtis Dixon. Can't get it through as Wagner soaks up his second of the game and fourth of the playoffs. Transition chance, Simmons again! Clearly, Albany saw that on film from Panther City a week ago, pushing that gentle transition, not to get a shot right away, but to get something off the bench.
And when you say transition, you immediately think of the two-on-ones, the one-on-nones. This was a four-on-three, and the patience from Wagner to kind of let San Diego's defense come on and say, okay, where is the open player? And the open player being Simmons on the backside with the hot stick and the best place shot of the night earlier. As we got a little scrap going, Eli Gobrick, and I don't see who that is for Albany, getting in each other's faces as tensions are rising. And Nardella wins the faceoff, so Albany with a little momentum right now.
Albany out to a two-goal lead, the first two-goal lead in the playoffs in this building, after every goal either tied or took the lead last week. San Diego with their backs against it a little bit as Albany starting to get comfortable. They scored three in a row in this game. Now Firth rolling, finds the middle, curls turned up away by Origlieri. A good look though by Albany, and that trend continues of quality offense.
And their spacing is just beautiful right there. Started with a low sweep, and oftentimes the two players that aren't sweeping can kind of get caught next to each other, but there was a clear crease player and a clear boards player.
Dobie's shot down low, but Jameson is there. And a penalty. And now Watkinson goes up at Dobie, and they're going to send both of them to the box.
Oh, wow. Dobie sold it enough to draw the penalty. You kind of see the, hey, ref, he was acting a little bit, but that's the crafty veteran, Dane Dobie.
Well, Colton Watkinson not impressed by Dane Dobie's audition, clearly. But the tape gets him the part as Watkinson joins
on the play.
Box.
San Diego, number 44, 2 minutes, goaltender interference. Number 44, 2 minute unsportsmanlike embellishment. Albany penalty, number 17, 2 minutes, dead ball foul.
So Albany will have a power play here.
The double whammy of embellishment and the unsportsmanlike off ball. And yeah, you know, we've seen Dane Dobie take a number of hits. That one kind of fell back. And the Academy Award goes to Dane Dobie, but it worked.
So it looks like we're going to play 5-on-4. A second player joins Dobie in the box. It's the in-home Jake Govett. So both of them will be in for two, as is Watkinson. So the offsetting penalties. This was the first penalty, the goaltender interference.
Yeah, and as Jameson comes through, you know, you just got to let him get the ball right there. And then Watkinson says, hey, I didn't like that you touched my goalie. Dobie sells it a little bit. Some good old-fashioned showmanship, but it is going to be Albany with the man-up opportunity.
Albany, last in the league on the power play this year, 0-for-8 a week ago against Halifax. Really a shocking statistic. Walker scores! 15 seconds of extra man time, and Albany opens up a 3-goal lead on a 4-0 run.
And again, I'll go back to the great spacing that Albany's offense is showing as we see Watkins and John a little bit, but they start from down low, and then as Walker gets the ball, the low man came up, and look at that pick, look at that seal right there that just gave him a clear lane for him to do what only Ethan Walker can do. All of his momentum going down towards the boards, and then with a flick of the wrist, snaps it to the backside.
Yeah, you mentioned that pick. Credit to Marshall Paulus, who has been such a difference maker for this team. Nishimura, unable to get it on net. It'll stay with Albany. They'll say it was touched by Gobrick.
But to finish the thought on Paulus, he's one of those players that is able to do a lot without touching the ball very frequently.
And those players are so valuable. You know, the good players and the goal scorers don't just do that on their own. You got to have guys like Paulus to grease the wheels.
Longboat lost his footing. Baptiste all over him against the boards. And a pop to Danny Logan. 4-0 Albany run as the Firewolves do not in any way look like the youngest, most inexperienced team in the league. They have their sights set on a trip to the finals. Trying to steal game one on the road. Austin Stotts can't get it on net. You have to wonder what the number that they need offensively, given the way Doug Jamison's been playing, as he's just able to cover it up.
And as you look at Doug Jamison, one of the things that you want to do is get consistently good looks, because when you shoot from outside and kind of let him settle in, it's almost like a bad shot that gets him comfortable will pay off negative dividends as the game goes on.
Albany attacking again. Simmons into the dangerous part of the floor. A rebound and a fresh shot clock. Nice work down low by Nathan Grant, and another one of those players that contributes a ton without touching the ball very much. Kurtz whips it to Firth. Chops around, now swings it to Simmons. Steps in, kicks save O'Riglieri, and hops right to Kurtz as this turns into a marathon possession for Albany. Tired defense on the floor.
If you're a young player watching, just look at the off-ball movement from Albany consistently. It is beautiful.
Now Simmons with space as Shume comes out to address him. Paulus peeling in. Kurtz up top! Oh, boy! Masterful work on offense to get Kurtz open, and it is a 5-0 run.
My goodness, I talked about the off-ball movement, and this is about as good as it gets. This was probably the 7th or 8th pick, starting off-ball with the C-cut coming from low right through the heart of the defense. And what's beautiful about that is every offensive player on Albany is on the same page. You see the ball carrier kind of sitting and hunting that assist, knowing that something is going to be open. And what's open? Ty Kurtz coming off a beautiful cut going low to high. Albany is firing on all cylinders right now.
5-0 Firewolf run as Albany has opened up a 4-goal lead on San Diego. And given the way Doug Jamison's been playing, not just the last few weeks, but all season, the guys wearing white have to be sitting on the bench thinking they're in a pretty good spot.
Well, and their game plan coming in was to execute on all fronts. And what have we seen? We've seen 2 goals in a 6-on-5. We've seen a man up, but we've seen good offense. And here is the face-off that I am not going to explain my negative thoughts on this, but Nardella and Baptiste going back and forth, and nothing happens, and now it's Albany ball. I'm sure Jerry Raganese might weigh in on Twitter about those long 50-50 clamps. Well, Jerry, you can speak to the positivity of that. I will remain silent.
All right, well, we'll step aside for a quick break. Albany on a 5-0 run. The kids might be new on the block, but they're burning them into the back of the net tonight.
GEICO can help cover cars, homes, motorcycles, and even accordions.
Pretty liberating knowing GEICO can help insure our car. And with our home insurance, your accordion, too.
We're not the only ones out here taking advantage of GEICO.
Smoke him, Edna. You sure showed him.
I bet your pickled peppers I did.
Whatever you need, from coverage to service, get more with GEICO.
Ever since I tried Hidden Valley Ranch, I finally found what I've been looking for.
Mm-hmm.
Oh my gosh.
I know. know. How is this stuff so good?
Hidden Valley Ranch.
Only serious about flavor!
Higher shipping rates may be the cost of doing business, but at what cost?
Turn shipping to your advantage with low-cost ground shipping from the United States Postal Service.
Albany opens up a four-goal lead on a 5-0 run. San Diego looking for answers, and their head coach is with Rayne Michaels.
Thanks, Cooper. Coach, earlier you told us about the game plan. What adjustments need to be made to get back to that plan?
We need to close gaps better, especially on their cross picks defensively. We need to win more 50-50 battles on the faceoffs, and honestly, we just got to start chipping away.
All right, thanks, Patty. Guys.
Albany will have the ball, leading by 4, and just simply clicking. Their offense is in perfect rhythm. Alex Sibbins conducting the symphony. He's got 2 goals. Ethan Walker with 1. Ty Kurtz has scored. Sam Firth has scored. Riglieri able to collect his own rebound. And a much-needed stop for San Diego as it kind of felt like things were starting to snowball.
It did a little bit, but keep in mind that San Diego's had some great defensive possessions, but you heard Patrick Merrill right there talk about those cross picks have been so effective for Albany.
Keep in mind, Doug Jamison in net for Albany gave up 3 goals last week against Halifax. He has a 4-goal lead to work with right now. A lot of confidence in that Albany back end at the moment. Stotts whips one from a low angle. And easy work for Jamison.
I'm not good at math. Is giving up 3 goals good as a goalie?
One of the best games ever.
Oh, that's good.
Albany trying to stack on top of already a 5-0 heater. Now Grennan right into the chest of Origlieri. Sykes peeling out. Seals looking to transition a little bit to maybe try and kickstart their offense.
Well, look at how many Albany players are on there right now and how San Diego still doesn't have their 5th player. So those little battles of who's getting to the box first, who's getting their players on first, Albany's been winning that consistently.
And that was something that was highlighted by Patrick Merrill talking about the film from last week. We'll get back to that. Here's Nishimura on a breakaway and able to get it on net. But he mentioned that Halifax was slow getting off, and it burned them consistently last week. San Diego kind of showing the same stuff right now, not very quick getting on and off.
And we've seen Albany capitalize on that. They do have a goal in transition, and they're just winning the battle of the gray areas, the 6-on-5s, the transition. And San Diego struggling to get looks in those transition opportunities.
Halfway through the second of game one of the NLL semifinals. 2-seed San Diego, 3-seed Albany. Kurtz was peeling towards the net but unable to handle the pass. Shot clock winding down. Simmons, Firth. And a possession shot won back by Firth. That's the hustle stuff that coaches love to see and often swings games.
And sometimes it's just a matter of lucky bounces. Firth shoots it off of his back foot with not much time as he uncorks one right there. Rebound, save, Origlieri, my goodness.
Back-to-back stops by Origlieri. Maybe that can give the offense a little bit of juice. San Diego clawing for anything right now. They've been held scoreless in this second quarter. Led 2-1, and Albany has dominated them since then. Now Stotts draws a penalty. Origlieri running to the bench, and Stotts taken down by the double team, ends the play, and will send San Diego to their 3rd power play.
You can't game plan against physics. When Austin Stotts decides to go head down, you gotta find a way to stop him, more often than not, resulting in a penalty.
Albany penalty number 27, 2 minutes holding.
Mike Byrne goes to the box. If you're San Diego going to the power play, plain and simple, you need a goal right now.
You absolutely need a goal. As we go back to how they got on the power play, just look at Austin Stotts bowling his way. Almost was ready for a suplex from the defender right there. But desperately need a goal, and it starts with ball movement.
Stotts to Doby. Gets it past Jamison, and there's the goal San Diego needed. welcome our new audience watching on ESPNU to Game 1 of the NLL Semifinals in San Diego. The San Diego Seals just snapped a 5-0 Albany run on the power play, and the timely goal comes just when they needed it.
And Dane Doby's been open pretty consistently. There have been some weird instances of him dropping the ball or the pass not getting there on time, but this one was executed to perfection. Stotts, who's been shooting it all night, drew the attention of two Albany shorthanded unit, leaving Doby wide open for the one-on-none. And if you're San Diego, you gotta ride this wave of momentum. Doug Jamison, the goaltender for Albany, a tough egg to crack.
Danny Logan wins the loose ball for San Diego, and they need to get it across before the 8-second count. Baptiste just able to beat the clock. Can San Diego now stack a couple to get back in this one? LeClaire attacking, LeClaire shooting. Nardella came over to block it as it's recovered by Berg with no reset. Hands free, Wesley Berg missed the cage entirely. Nishimura ends the possession.
Two decent looks right there. You had Trey LeClaire dodging on Joe Nardella, and then Wesley Berg sweeping across with no pressure. So even though you didn't get a goal right there, those are two pretty quality looks from San Diego.
Alex Simmons with two goals in this game. Now here's Ethan Walker. He's added two of his own. Palace wicks it back up to Simmons. Palace. Kellen LeClaire scoops it up. Back in the lineup after a scratch a week ago. LeClaire trying to contribute for San Diego. There is Dixon starting to survey, initiates the offense with Wesley Berg. Dixon turned away, and now Stotts has to go retrieve the loose ball. Shot clock at 7 seconds. Stotts off balance, and that was less good defense and more a discombobulated offensive sequence for the Seals, as it will take us to our final break of the first half. If you're watching on ESPN News, flip over to ESPNU to join us for the rest of this one, as Albany leads San Diego 6-3 with just under 5 minutes to go in the first half.
GEICO can help cover cars, homes, motorcycles, and even accordions.
Pretty liberating knowing GEICO can help insure our car. And with our home insurance, your accordion, too.
We're not the only ones out here taking advantage of GEICO.
Smoking eggnog.
You sure showed it.
I bet your pickled peppers I did.
Whatever you need, from coverage to service, get more with GEICO.
Our biggest challenge? Uncertainty. Hidden fees, surcharges, who knows what to expect?
Turn shipping to your advantage.
Keep it simple with clear upfront pricing.
With USPS Ground Advantage.
It's how you keep it going, rain or shine. Kingsford is how you do it.
Stallions and Showboats are on ABC and ESPN Plus at noon Eastern, and the Roughnecks square off against the Battlehawks on Fox. Sunday, Fox has a doubleheader. The Renegades look for their first win against the Panthers at 1 Eastern, followed by the Brahmas and DC Defenders. 4:58 left in the first half. Albany leading San Diego 6-3. Widely considered underdogs in this series, the youngest team in the league has played like a group of veterans, capitalizing on three extra man situations, 2 6-on-5s, and a true power play. They scored five consecutive at one point.
What I'm curious to see is if San Diego is going to try and push transition. They have an opportunity to do that here.
They thought about it, and instead Rubish and Bradley will get off, and half the shot clock remains for San Diego. Now Berg shopping around. Time, 7 seconds left. Dixon mishandles. And Jamison reads it cleanly.
There are just some uncharacteristic things happening with the San Diego offense right now. Like, even as I see Dixon drop that ball, we see Dobie drop a ball earlier. Just a little bit of a head scratcher here. So we'll see if San Diego can clean that up before half.
You contrast that against the Firewolves, who are executing nearly flawlessly.
And I mean, look at how much movement there is out there on the floor right now.
That and their crisp passing. Simmons shoulder save O'Reilly. A loose ball push goes against Longbow. San Diego trying to close the first half on a run to get back in this one after falling behind by four. Wildly different script than a week ago against Panther City in this building. Austin Stott squares up Watkinson, backs him in. And they get LeClaire pushing off.
And that's a great defensive possession by Albany. What I'm really impressed by is their consistent pressure on whoever the ball carrier is, but in particular Austin Stotts. We talked about how difficult he is to stop when he gets momentum. They're not even letting the train get off the tracks.
Albany trying to attack, working through Walker as the pass kicks up by at the boards. And last touch by Rubish, another unfortunate bounce for San Diego, where it turns the ball to Albany. Under 3 minutes left as the upstart Firewolves continuing to make their statement in this first half. Kurtz backpedaling, Simmons up high. Now Bradley trying to run for San Diego.
Great save by Origlieri right there. Simmons with a little bit of time and room. Not an easy stop, but Origlieri saw it the entire way. And even though the score is a 3 deficit for San Diego, Origlieri's played quite well.
San Diego finally gets their offense on. They only have 8 seconds on the shot clock. Dobie muscling in. He had Simmons trapped back on defense, but credit the rookie for doing a nice job.
You know, if I had to make up a stat right now, it would be the true offensive possession time. Because San Diego, when they get their 5th offensive player on, it seems like they consistently have 15 or 10 seconds to work with. And here's Albany with a full 23.
A stark difference between these two teams and their approaches tonight. Walker finds an open Paulus, hits the pipe.
Boy, and if Albany can get that 2-man game working, I mean, everything that they're throwing at San Diego is getting them good looks right now.
So now LeClaire initiating the righty side. Step down for Stotts, passes it up. Shoulders in. And off a hesitation, easy work for Jamison, just closing the 5-hole.
And look at that pressure that was on Stotts. We'll keep an eye on that as the game progresses, but they're just making his life difficult tonight.
Nearing the 1 minute mark in the first half. Simmons, 2 first half goals. Off to Grennan. And Grennan able to get it back. Another hustle play comes up white.
And you have to start wondering how this is wearing on San Diego's defense. That's probably the 4th or 5th time that they've gotten an extra possession, let alone the ones that they've gotten 2 or 3 on.
Can't connect with a cutting Kurtz. Still 12 seconds, the shot clock. Walker on the run. Hand saved by O'Reilly. San Diego, 40 seconds until halftime. Wesley Bird! The captain scores his first of the postseason and cuts the San Diego deficit to 2.
Wesley Burke just says, I'll take it from here. And in their first quote-unquote transition goal of the day, it's actually 3 San Diego players and all 5 Albany players. And Wesley Burke just catches it and fires it, sneaking it past a red-hot goalie in Jamison. That is exactly what San Diego needed. And we talked about how Berg and Dixon put up goose eggs last week and how we should not expect that here tonight. Well, Dixon got one earlier. Berg gets on the
scoring sheet right there. Watch out.
Oh, final 20 seconds. And San Diego comes up with a timeout immediately called by Patrick Merrill.
Let's go back to last week. Final seconds of the first half. San Diego down by one. Jordan Hall draws up the perfect play. Dane Doby scores with 2.5 seconds left. And it felt like that totally took the wind out of Panther City's sails. It's a two-goal game right now, but can they accomplish the same thing with a goal in these final 16 seconds?
I don't see any reason why we think that shouldn't be the case. And we talk about those last couple second goals. Well, Albany got one in the first quarter, and they used that momentum to dominate the first half of the second quarter. So if San Diego can get a goal right here, not all goals are created equal, and that one would be absolutely massive. And you look at who has the hot hand. I think Dobie's consistently gotten Jameson out of position better than any other San Diego player. So look for them, just like they did last week, to try and get the ball into 44's godlike left hand.
Dobie with two goals tonight. Only San Diego player with multiple tallies. The others belonging to Curtis Dixon and Wesley Berg, who collectively were held without a goal last week by Panther City in the quarterfinals. Here in game one of the semis, Doug Jameson and Albany making a first half statement using a 5-0 run to open up what was once a 4-goal lead. Did San Diego cut it to one before the break? Shot clock is off, final 10 seconds. Dixon and Berg switch places. Here go the Seals into their offense. Stotts on a step down. Feeds LeClaire, time running out. And Albany able to bust up the pass before the buzzer. They got it on net, but it doesn't matter. So Albany gets the stop that they need, and it culminates a very impressive opening 30 minutes for the Albany Firewolves.
And I think that defensive stand right there at the end kind of represents what's gone right for them, which is not only taking away some of those shooting lanes, but just objectively making it difficult for San Diego. Nothing's come easy for San Diego, especially on the offensive side of the floor tonight. And then you combine that with consistent quality looks on offense and Doug Jameson playing goaltender. I mean, my goodness, Albany is putting together the perfect game plan, but San Diego always comes out a half ready to fight back.
Well, the story coming in, the youngest roster in the league against the oldest roster in the league, and the conductor of this youthful symphony is Alex Simmons. He's down on the floor with Rayne Michaels.
Thanks, Cooper. Alex, what are you seeing out of the Seals defense that's allowing you to score?
I mean, they're strong and athletic. They're obviously got a lot of seasoned veterans out there, so they're making it kind of difficult to get some shots off, but you know, we've just got to stick to our game plan, keep swinging the ball, and we'll be successful.
And you guys have the lead right now. What do you need to do in the second half to maintain it?
Just keep doing what we're doing. You know, I like our pace. You know, we got to their goalie early, and we just got to continue to get shots, continue to move the ball like we talked about, and we'll be all right.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Guys.
Okay, he's smiling. He's having a great time out there.
Albany wraps up a dominant first half with a two-goal lead and quieting the San Diego crowd. Halftime coverage coming up after a short break. You're watching the NLL semifinals.
GEICO can help cover cars, homes, motorcycles, and even accordions.
Pretty liberating knowing GEICO can help insure our car. And with our home insurance, you're accordion, too.
We're not the only ones out here taking advantage of GEICO.
Smoking it now.
You sure showed it.
I bet your pickled peppers I did.
Whatever you need, from coverage to service, get more with GEICO.
Our biggest challenge? Uncertainty. Hidden fees, surcharges, who knows what to expect?
Turn shipping to your advantage.
Keep it simple with clear upfront pricing.
With USPS Ground Advantage.
Ever since our tournament leader started dipping what appears to be a chicken tender in Hidden Valley Ranch, he's just stopped playing.
To be fair, Bill, it does look zesty.
Hit the ball! Sorry
for raising my voice.
Hidden Valley Ranch.
Only serious about flavor.
Geico can help when you're locked out with their easy app and 24/7 help.
Dad, you don't have to make this so tough on yourself. Geico can help us get into our locked car. See?
Yeah, but where's the fun of that? Maybe I'm just nostalgic for the good old days. Before we had Geico's great coverage and 24/7 help.
All set, guys.
Oh. Let's go again.
Whatever you need, from coverage to service, get more with Geico.
Our biggest challenge? Uncertainty. Hidden fees, surcharges, who knows what to expect?
Turn shipping to your advantage.
Keep it simple with clear upfront pricing.
With USPS Ground Advantage.
Ever since our tournament leader started dipping what appears to be a chicken tender in Hidden Valley Ranch, he's just stopped playing.
To be fair, Bill, it does look zesty.
Hit the ball! Sorry
for raising my voice.
Hidden Valley Ranch.
Only serious about flavor.
All flights canceled.
There's places in life you just don't want to be.
Getting a crash and being in a courtroom without us? Well, that's one of those places.
We know how to get
back to force a game three. Meanwhile, San Diego and Albany halfway through game one with the Fire Wolves, a 6-4 advantage. For more on the other game on the opposite side of the bracket that already concluded tonight, John Abbott and Pat Gregoire.
The Toronto Rock had home floor to start game number one of the NLL semifinals. However, the Buffalo Bandits quickly changed that into their advantage, heading back to Buffalo for game two after a 12-4 victory against the Toronto Rock. Pat, it was the Bandits that showed why they are defending champs. They were full value in almost every end of the floor. It started early for Ian McKay, and it didn't stop from there.
It certainly did not, John. And a lot of people, when you talk about the Buffalo Bandits, you look immediately at Dane Smith and Josh Byrne. Sure, they were great, but the transition took over this game early on. You talked about it. Ian McKay, an X factor in this series, picks up a loose ball, goes coast to coast to open up this scoring. How about the pick from Steve Priolo? He would not be done. He was a menace all night long. Picks off this pass from Mark Matthews and starts the transition once again. Finds a streaking Dylan Robinson, who then hits Chase Fraser off the bench. 6 of the 12 goals, John, scored in transition here tonight for the Bandits.
And as if that wasn't enough, Toronto thought they had one, only to have it undone and then work against them even further.
Turning point was huge here as Tom Schreiber thought it was 3-1. Beautiful shot. Transition goes the other way. It turns out, after seeing this, Chris Bouchy in the crease. Matt Sawyer thought he might have reestablished himself out, but unfortunately, they already used their challenge.
And the 40-something Matt Vince, looking like he's turned back the clock. He was unbelievable, Pat.
They call him Vino. I know it's because of his last name, but also because he's aging like a fine wine. 52 stops here tonight. Wasn't just making saves from the outside, eating up those shots. He made some 10 bellers on the crease. We didn't see Toronto get to the middle all too often, but when he did, he was nothing short of superb.
And so the Bandits win yet another battle between these two rivals. Buffalo has now won the last 7 playoff games against Toronto. The Rock trying not to get swept, Pat. It is all on the line in Buffalo on Sunday, 5:30 Eastern. The Bandits, one win away from going back to the NLL final.
Well, John mentioned it's Sunday afternoon. It's a semifinal game two doubleheader right here on ESPNU. First, at 3 o'clock Eastern, catch the second installment of tonight's game when the Seals travel to Albany. Then directly following at 5:30, the Toronto Rock head to Banditland for their game two matchup. Will the Bandits secure their place in the NLL Finals, or will the Rock force a game three back in Rock City? Both games will also stream on ESPN Plus and TSN Plus. Halftime here in San Diego. Albany with a 6-4 lead on the Seals.
Geico can help cover cars, homes, motorcycles, and even accordions.
Pretty liberating knowing Geico can help insure our car. And with our home insurance, your accordion too.
We're not the only ones out here taking advantage of Geico.
Smoking Edna. You sure should.
I bet your pickled peppers I did.
Whatever you need, from coverage to service, get more with Geico.
Our biggest challenge? Uncertainty. hidden fees, surcharges. Who knows what to expect?
Turn shipping to your advantage.
Keep it simple with clear upfront pricing.
With USPS Ground Advantage.
Ever since our tournament leader started dipping what appears to be a chicken tender in Hidden Valley Ranch, he's just stopped playing.
To be fair, Bill, it does look zesty.
Hit the ball!
Sorry for raising my voice.
Hidden Valley Ranch.
Only serious about flavor.
Sure, there's food at home. But isn't a McDouble with extra pickles, a side of fries, and a high C at home? Don't be ridiculous.
All flights canceled.
There's places in life you just don't want to be.
Get in a crash and be in a courtroom without us? Well, that's one of those places.
We know how to get you everything you deserve.
At Harding Mazzotti, we think big.
The NLL playoffs are brought to you by NLLShop.com, a Fanatics experience, officially licensed everything. Halftime in San Diego, Albany with a 6-4 lead on the home Seals, and a fascinating first half because it looked like things were headed on one trajectory and then made a hard left turn. San Diego scored the game's first goal 40 seconds in when Dane Doby beat Doug Jamison. And the whole crowd was thinking, oh, wait, this is how it's going to be. But Alex Simmons said not so fast. Curtis Dixon put San Diego up 2-1. And after that, it was essentially all Albany.
And it's just beautiful team offense. You look at their off-ball movement. You look at their spacing. This is a unit that is firing on all cylinders. And let's not forget, they have 3 goals in special teams, 2 6-on-5 and 1 on the power play. So they are really taking advantage of the transition and the special teams, as we see just good ball movement, making space for guys like Ethan Walker to do that.
San Diego, though, did respond as Dane Doby gets one on the power play to end that 5-0 run. And Wesley Berg, in an unsettled situation, cuts it to 2. Albany gets a stop in the closing seconds of the first half, and the stats shake out a little bit like this. Fascinating to see the loose ball battle essentially even, because the way it's felt is Albany has dominated the 50-50s in this game.
And a lot of those loose balls, you see 34 of them. I'd say about 10 of them have come on the offensive side of the floor for Albany, giving them 2 or 3, sometimes even 4 possessions in a row, which is going to wear out the San Diego defense and make Albany's offense that much more comfortable.
Albany out shooting San Diego by a factor of 50% as well. Firewolves might be young, but they have played well through 30 minutes, 6-4 at halftime in San Diego.
GEICO can help cover cars, homes, motorcycles, and even accordions.
Pretty liberating knowing GEICO can help insure our car. And with our home insurance, your accordion, too.
We're not the only ones out here taking advantage of GEICO.
Smoking Edna. You sure should.
I bet your pickled peppers I did.
Whatever you need, from coverage to service, get more with GEICO.
Our biggest challenge? Uncertainty. Hidden fees, surcharges, who knows what to expect?
Turn shipping to your advantage.
Keep it simple with clear upfront pricing.
With USPS Ground Advantage.
is how you keep it going, rain or shine. Kingsford is how you do it.
Injured in a car crash? Remember the three Z's.
Zip.
Zero.
Zilch.
At Harding Mazzotti, we win or you pay nothing. It's our no-fee policy. Nothing when you call and not a dime until we win your case.
Zip.
Zero.
Zilch.
Nada. You pay nothing out of pocket. Injured in a car crash? Remember the three Z's.
Zip.
Zero.
Zilch.
It's our no-fee policy.
Hurt your body? Call Harding Mazzotti.
Think big.
Call 1-800-LAW-1010.
Think big.
The next up on the F1 schedule is the third annual Crypto.com Miami Grand Prix at the Miami International Autodrome at Hard Rock Stadium. Our coverage begins Sunday afternoon at 3:30 Eastern, 12:30 Pacific with Grand Prix Sunday. And the race starts at 4 Eastern, 1 Pacific on ABC, ESPN Deportes, and ESPN+. Well, Albany outshot San Diego 27-18 in the first half, which means Seals goaltender Chris O'Riglieri had quite a bit of work cut out for him. Rain Michaels down between the benches has more on the San Diego netminder.
Yeah, guys, I caught up with Chris earlier about his debut playoff performance last week and what his mindset was like heading into that game and this one. And he told me that it was all about keeping it business as usual. He said every game you play in this league is so important for different reasons. When we spoke to head coach Patrick Merrill earlier about Chris, he said he's doing a great job at staying in the moment and just focusing on that next save. That's just the kind of guy he is. Guys, back to you.
So, back to action to start the third quarter. Albany used a 5-0 run to take what was a 4-goal lead at one point. San Diego chipped away to score the last two of the first half. And now back to what has been maybe the most competitive battle of the night, the Dot. Trevor Baptiste and Joe Nardella, pretty much right down the middle between the two of them, and it has been a battle.
And every time you have a draw that lasts more than 2 or 3 seconds, look at how quickly those players collapse. And so great job right there by Cam Holding. And that's one of the rare quick possessions coming off of a draw here tonight.
And we've seen a handful of marathon faceoffs. The San Diego trying to get their offense going with a little bit more time on the shot clock. Very slow changing in the first half. And it finds its way into the net. Call it a hockey goal, deflected out front, and it sneaks in.
Just like they drew it up, the missed pass into the goal. As the two-man game stays lethal on the right side for San Diego, we see Trey LeClaire. I mean, and what more can you do than laugh at that? He lobs a pass into Westberg. Good defense by Albany, actually bites them in the back. And look at Wesley Berg just raising his hand. Sometimes you need a lucky break, and San Diego gets one right there.
It looked like that got through clean as well.
It did.
That's a Trey LeClaire goal. That's not a Wesley Berg goal.
On the slowest shot in quotes in the history of Pechanga Arena, Trey LeClaire with a 20-mile-an-hour heater.
23 seconds into the third quarter. Dane Doby scored 20 seconds into the first quarter as San Diego jumped out to a 2-1 lead before Albany's 5-0 run. Now the Firewolves have seen that lead chip down to one goal and a 3-0 San Diego run. Simmons, his hat trick answers. The moment is not too big for the 25-year-old, and the rookie has three.
And this is just a rookie playing like a veteran. Look at how he scans and reacts to what San Diego is doing. He says, we're not going to force ourselves on you. We're going to wait and see what you give us. And San Diego did not close out and go and get on his hands. So as he's shopping around for what to do, he realizes, I got my hands, I got my feet, I'm going to uncork one. And I was going to be really curious to see, because sometimes those bad break goals, the one that Trey LeClair scored seconds ago, can take the wind out of your sails, but not the sails of the Albany Firewolves.
Alex Simmons. 6 hat tricks in the regular season, but only 3 in the last 15 games, has his first career postseason hat trick, and has his Firewolves back out by a deuce just over a minute into the second half. Walker works it down to Firth. Firth scored once in the first half. Now Kurtz thought about stepping into one. Spins away. Baptiste comes over. Feeds the middle. Grenin! Back-to-back Albany goals, and it's back to a 3-goal marker.
And this is just what Albany's done so well all night, is all 5 players moving, all 5 players being a threat. As they try to initiate a 2-man game with the righties, the lefties are just as active, causing havoc with the 3-man unit as Grenin finds himself naked in the middle of the floor, buries it, and those back-to-back goals for Albany, very, very impressive.
3 assists on the night now for Ty Kurtz, as he feeds Grenin for his first goal of the postseason. Signed as a free agent in the offseason after playing a couple seasons for Panther City. And one of the most annoying players in the league to have to compete against. Ask anybody. Nathan Grenin makes life extremely difficult on opposing defenses.
And he just has a motor. He seems to not get tired. He's going to be sending 3 or 4 picks almost every second. He has Energizer Bunny status.
Now Paulus works it over to Simmons, shopping around for a moment, and a moving screen as Cam Holding taken down. Now Patrick Schumann pushing ahead for the Seals, slams on the brakes and drops it out to Stotts. Austin Stotts attacking Wagner. Burns showed a quick slide, then backed off. Now over to Dixon. 3 goals in this third quarter, just over 2 minutes in, as Dixon's shot whistles wide. Gets it back, and they give him a reset of the shot clock. Now a penalty against Byrne as Dixon out front backhands it. And Doby able to recover. Here's the 6-on-5 as Origlieri hit the bench, and Trey LeClair joins the offense.
Great individual effort by Dixon to get his own rebound there.
Stott swings it over to Dixon. Albany scored 2 6-on-5s in the first half. San Diego trying to get one of their own. Dixon trying to find Govett, shot clock about to run out, and Doby will not be able to get one away before the 30 expires.
You know, and something that's surprised me about the San Diego offense tonight is the quality of passes. I'll expand more after the call right here.
Albany, number 27, 2 minutes holding.
But the quality of passes, meaning that to have good ball movement, those passes need to be up in the box, which is right above the shoulder where all the sticks are. Too many San Diego passes have been down at the feet.
San Diego 1-for-3 on the power play tonight. They got a big one from Dane Doby to stop the 5-0 run by Albany, but now trailing by 3 once again after back-to-back Firewolf goals. Berg running the point, trades places with Stotts. Back to Berg. Doby trying to get that high corner. Shot clock will not reset as Berg gets it back. 3 seconds. Dixon beats Jamison Lowe!
What great back-to-back shifts by Curtis Dixon. Not only does he get his own rebound and draw the foul that put them in the power play originally, but with the shot clock winding down, he knew that he had about 2 seconds to catch and fire, which is plenty of time for Superman Curtis Dixon. And that's exactly what you need right there as he gets his 128th career playoff point.
Putting him in 6th place all time. Now 66 career playoff goals. It's one more to tie Gary Gate for third all time, two more to pass. His Seals and former Roughnecks teammate Dane Dolby with two tonight, up to 82. He needs three to track down John Tavares for the most in playoff history. So big one on the power play, chops it back to two goals as Dixon passes Sean Evans on the points list.
Well, what's interesting is we look at two goals apiece in the second half for each team. I look at the quality of those two goals. You got Curtis Dixon sneaking one by with a low shot clock on a power play and Trey LeClaire pass shooting on a missed Wesley Bird catch. But contrast that with Albany's two goals. Great off-ball movement to get Grennan the ball and Simmons hunting and executing beautifully. I got to say, if I'm taking two goals, I'm taking Albany's two goals.
So at the moment, we've had a little delay because the house replay is currently not working, which means the obligatory two looks cannot be shown in the Jumbotron, which is currently being explained to Glenn Clark. So I don't know how you remedy this situation and keep it within the bounds of the rules.
Luckily, that wasn't a diving close one. That was Curtis Dixon from range.
Granted, it was at the end of the shot clock, which does complicate things a little bit. It looked as though Dixon beat the clock cleanly, and it wasn't all that close with about a second and a half left. But still, if you're Glenn Clark in Albany, you'd very much like an explanation of it, at least why it's not being reviewed.
You know, we've spoken all year about how this is a one-goal league. It's a game of inches. It's a game of seconds. Heck, we've seen two goals today with under 2 seconds left. But luckily, in order to pass the time while the referees do some explaining, the YMCA is playing, so the fans are still fired up getting into it. As we see him go over to explain the situation to head coach Patrick Merrill, just making sure that all the coaches are on the same page here.
It looks like we're ready to get back to lacrosse as Baptiste and Ardello renew at the dot as the two of them have been battling all evening. Just about right down the middle. 8 wins for San Diego, 7 for Albany. And we might get another long one here. A couple of marathons tonight as two of the best faceoff men in the world doing battle. A couple of great faceoff matchups in the semifinals. On the other side of the bracket, Connor Farrell and TD Erlin. That's an awesome one as well.
It is, and you know, it kind of gives credence to the faceoffs matter side, which is always a constant argument on lacrosse Twitter. And we have another 50-50 loose ball. Here comes Joe Nardella.
Nardella can't get it on net as Danny Logan closes to disrupt his shooting motion. And now Cam Holding trying to get away from Nick Chaikowski, who's all over him. And credit to this Albany team riding as hard as possible, and they take it away from San Diego. Just this youthful energy seems to apply to every facet of their game.
Really impressive stuff, and particularly Cam Holding and Trey LeClaire are two guys who I'd select almost 1 and 2 overall on San Diego to get the ball across the floor and maintain possession. Really good ride.
Now Ethan Walker looking for space off to Kurtz. Shot clock under 10 seconds. Kurtz kicked away, penalty away from the ball. Jamison late breaking towards the bench, but a reset of the shot clock gives him plenty of time. So another 6-on-5. Albany has converted 2 of their 3 6-on-5s tonight into goals. And they'll have Walker with Simmons, Kurtz, Longboat, Firth, and Paulus, and unable to get a shot away. They will head to the power play, however. Looks like Matt Sykes will do the walk to the penalty box.
And coming into this game, we talked about the importance of discipline, and it was echoed by head coach Patrick Merrill, because Albany's game last week against Halifax had a crazy amount of penalties. San Diego has to try and do their best to stay out of the box, been unsuccessful at that tonight.
Albany went 0-for-8 a week ago. They're 1-for-1 tonight. Kurtz kicked away by O'Riglieri. Walker retrieves it, reset of the 30-second shot clock. Firth now flips it off to Walker. It is Firth who retains possession back to Paulus. Off to Simmons. Interesting to see Walker working up high with Simmons down low. Now Simmons comes out to set a pick. Walker, shot deflected. Kurtz able to win the loose ball back. No reset of the shot clock. Now Walker. Kurtz with space. Kurtz. A big save by O'Reilly. And finally San Diego can clear.
Good job by San Diego's shorthanded unit to not only defend the middle of the field, but to get into those shooting lanes. Usually the mark of a good shorthanded unit, defend the middle, get in the shooting lanes. They do that well.
Stotts trying to force his way past Watkinson underneath. Now off to Dixon. Shot clock under 10. Dixon sweeping. Dixon saved by Jamison. Recovered by Doby, and San Diego can try to eat another 30. Doby spins away, maintains possession, and goes falling down without a call as Wagner comes up with it, and Albany will have one more quality possession before the penalty expires.
And even though they weren't able to maintain possession and run out more clock, that's a great effort by Dane Doby to eat up some of those valuable power play seconds.
Best story in the league this season, the Albany Firewolves with a two-goal lead on the road in game one of the semis. Simmons with three tonight. Simmons adds a fourth. Have a night, Alex Simmons.
Just a rookie, but showing unbelievable versatility and IQ. Alex Simmons, we've seen him shoot from the outside. San Diego tries to close out, and with just a little bit of a pick, he makes his way and gets his momentum going towards the goal. And even with Graydon Bradley all over him, able with a flick of the wrist to shoot it far side, an unbelievable performance Alex Simmons is putting on at Pechanga Arena tonight.
Three teams passed on him in the 2022 draft, and he is likely to be the rookie of the year in 2024 when it's all said and done. Between the regular season and postseason, Alex Simmons with 43 goals in his first year of NLL action. Just wild numbers. Over and back goes against Albany, gives possession to San Diego. And it looks like we're going to have a penalty. Nick Chaykowski was up against the boards, and Cam Holding being ushered to the penalty box. San Diego's headed right back to the penalty kill.
Here come the Boo Birds in San Diego as Wes Bird comes over, try and get a little clarity.
San Diego 19, major penalty, plays automatically under review.
A major penalty against Cam Holding, who did not take a penalty in 17 regular season games. And this has the potential to be a massive swing.
It does, and you know, this is gonna be interesting to watch on the replay as Cam Holding just hits him right into the boards. But you know, you mentioned his clean slate. He is not the dirty player. And I almost feel like a ricochet effect of those long face-off tie-ups is it allows everybody to get a little bit more chippy, and we'll see if they uphold this major penalty. But those major penalties are in place to protect the players, and anytime a player gets hit into the boards, it's certainly gonna get called. It's just a matter of, is it gonna be a minor or a major? And as we go back to see the other replay, we just see Cam Holding battling for the ball, throwing a stick check, and I think it might be that extension of the right elbow that might cause this to be upheld, because both of their momentum was heading into the board with Cam Holding on the back. I think it's just that right elbow extension that sent him into the boards that might be a bit of a nightmare 5-minute penalty kill that San Diego's staring in the face right now.
Albany is a perfect 2-for-2 on the power play tonight after finishing last in the league in power play percentage during the regular season and going 0-for-8 a year ago. They've completely flipped the script tonight.
And as we go back, watch Cameron Holding's right elbow just right there. I think that if I'm a referee reviewing it, that might be the make or break body part that I'm analyzing. And it looks like they have a little more talking to do. But credit to Albany's power play unit. They have just had crisp ball movement and effective shooting all night as we go in for the call. where I thought we'd go in for the call. Now we go.
After review, the major penalty has been downgraded to a minor penalty for boarding. 2 minutes.
So holding has his major downgraded to a minor. Now 2 minutes instead of five, which is a very significant development for both of these teams.
Yeah, and you know, knowing Cameron Holding, there was no malicious intent, so I think that's the right call by the refs.
Firth, Walker, Kurtz, Simmons, Longboat on the power play for Albany. Simmons up top, Simmons face dodges. Origlieri the save, but it pops right to Kurtz for a second chance.
That was exactly the same look that got them a goal, executed to perfection once again. Huge save by Origlieri.
The San Diego penalty kill had been exceptional down the stretch of the season, but doesn't look like it tonight as Kyle Rubish doing what he's made a career out of, taking the ball away.
And he just makes it look so easy, because when you're getting ready to make that pass, you see the body position of mostly the core. You just see the uniform. But what he does such a good job of is fully extending his left hand and stick to get in that passing lane. Executed to perfection there.
And they get San Diego in the crease. So Albany back to work, still half the power play. And Kurtz will bring it up. Or the Simmons, I should say, joined by Kurtz. Albany 2-for-2 on the extra man, plus 6 on 5s have gone their way. They've scored twice in those settings tonight. Walker whips it behind. Paulus looking to feed. Dangerous passer. Simmons denied by Origlieri on a beauty of a pass by Marshall Paulus.
Boy, he caught me right there. I was expecting him to move it in front. So what does he do? Throw a behind the back cross crease pass. Huge stop again by Origlieri.
San Diego can take the penalty down to about 12 seconds if they use every second of the shot clock. Jake Govett running around. Now up to Wesley Berg, who has to play goalie on it. Berg shooting up into the net. Albany will have it with 14 more seconds on the power play. But they will have to wait for those final 14 seconds after a quick break. Albany up 9-6, trying to build when we come back. Welcome back as San Diego successfully kills off the final 14 seconds of the penalty. Now Austin Stotts, head fake, shoots. Wide of the net, no reset. Berg off to Dixon, isolates on Jokum. Trying to force feed Wardle cutting to the net, and Albany does a nice job to clog the passing lane.
And look at how well Albany is executing their defensive playbook. I wouldn't be surprised if getting on the hands of Austin Stotts was almost priority number one, as he had 4 goals last week. He has not had a hands-free shot all night.
Simmons with 4 already tonight. Make it 5! Alex Simmons matches his season high, and it's back to a 4-goal Albany lead, matching their largest of the game. A new seal killer is developing here in San Diego.
5 goals in 5 different ways. He hasn't really hit that jab step hitch to the middle, and he executes it beautifully right there. And even as we see defenseman Eli Gobrik go to close out, what Simmons did a great job of was initiating that jab step with enough space to where if he just planted his feet, he was able to have an open shot. I mean, this man is a rookie, but he is playing like he has 10 years of experience in his belt. What a performance. Alex Simmons, my goodness.
The playoffs make stars and legends, and Alex Simmons is starting to write his own story in his first year in the league. 5 goals in game one of the semifinals on the road against the number 2 seed San Diego Seals, the oldest and most experienced roster in the league. Albany doesn't care about that tonight. The Firewolves lead by 4. Stotts drops it off to Holding, getting a shift of offense. Wesley Berg steps and rips, and Jamison denies it. and a whistle blows the play dead. Looks like we're going to have a penalty against Patrick Kaschuk.
Albany penalty number 19, 2 minutes illegal body check.
So San Diego a few times tonight has had big opportunities on power plays to try and get themselves back in the game. They'll have a chance when we come back trailing 10-6, 4:57 to go in the third.
GEICO can help when you're locked out with their easy app and 24/7 help.
Dad, you don't have to make this so tough on yourself. GEICO can help us get into our locked car. See?
Yeah, but where's the fun of that? Maybe I'm just nostalgic for the good old days. Before we had GEICO's great coverage and 24/7 help.
All set, guys. Oh.
Let's go again.
Whatever you need, from coverage to service, get more with GEICO.
When we say it'll be on time, they expect it to be on time.
Turn shipping to your advantage.
Keep those expectations with reliable ground shipping.
Thanks, Brandon.
With USPS Ground Advantage.
Captain, ever since you discovered Zesty Hidden Valley Ranch, you never stay in character anymore.
You know we're not actually pirates, right?
Of course we be pirates. Look at me, Hook.
Hidden Valley Ranch.
Only serious about flavor.
All flights canceled.
There's places in life you just don't want to be.
Get in a crash and be in a courtroom without us? Well, that's one of those places.
We know how to get...
And team gear today. The Albany Firewolves have opened up a 4-goal lead, matching their largest of the night. Riding Alex Simmons, the rookie, matching his career high with 5 goals and 9 points. Still with 4:57 to go in the third, but right now it is the Seals, 2-for-4 on the power play tonight with a chance to chip into this deficit. Since Albany took the lead at 3-2, they have been in control, really without exception. Seals pulled within one at the start of the third, but things have ballooned back to 4. Dixon to Stotts, they can't connect, and it pops right to an Albany waiting defender as Jackson Nishimura.
And you know, you just see a little miscommunication right there, thinking that Austin Stotts was going to be looking for the step down, but he's making the cut, and all of a sudden you're losing valuable seconds. As Albany wins a 2-on-1 loose ball that's going to eat those valuable seconds.
They have won the hard work battles tonight. I think unquestionably they have been the team that has fought harder for those loose balls, and it's shown consistently.
It has, and even with a look like that, you know, talking to head coach Patrick Merrill, he was talking about the importance of winning those while Albany's coming in and flipping the script on what Patrick Merrill was trying to execute on.
1:14 still to go on the power play. San Diego trying to get back within 3, 10-6, late third quarter.
GEICO can help cover cars, homes, motorcycles, and even accordions.
Pretty liberating knowing GEICO can help insure our car. And with our home insurance, your accordion, too.
We're not the only ones out here taking advantage of GEICO.
Smoking, Edna. You sure showed it.
I bet your pickled peppers I did.
Whatever you need, from coverage to service, get more with GEICO.
When we say it'll be on time, they expect it to be on time.
Turn shipping to your advantage.
Keep those expectations with reliable ground shipping.
Thanks, Brandon.
With USPS Ground Advantage.
It's how you keep it going, rain or shine. Kingsford is how you do it.
Riley, how was camp?
And they have been in control for most of it. After a back-and-forth first quarter, the Firewolves went on a 5-0 run, now matching their largest lead of 4. Can the Seals cut back into it? Austin Stotts, LeClair turned away by Jameson. Fresh 30 seconds, still a minute on the power play. Berg, LeClair can't handle the pass.
And the sloppiness continues for San Diego's offense. Berg back to Stotts. Dixon down low. Doby. Berg throws one behind the back. 12 seconds to shoot. Dixon. Doby feeding Berg. Unable to get a shot away as John Wagner ties him up. And the incredible playoff beginnings of John Wagner continue. What an incredible acquisition he's been since the trade deadline when they picked him up from Las Vegas.
And you know, you look at his stat line last week, goals, assists, loose balls, caused turnovers. I mean, the human Swiss Army knife having a massive impact and a big reason why Albany's been so successful.
Firewolves playing like a veteran team tonight. Ty Kurtz looking for his second, twists it on net, and another rebound controlled by the Firewolves. We've said it ad nauseum tonight. The Firewolves winning the hard work battles. They've killed off the penalty. Back to 5-on-5, and they'll have just under 20 seconds to work with on the shot clock. Down low to Walker. Trying to initiate. Gets around on Bradley. Now to Simmons. 5 goals and 9 points tonight, both matching career highs. Shot clock running out. Simmons trapped by a double team and gets it near pipe, but Origliere able to make the stop.
Good defense right there by San Diego as they were double teaming and applying pressure to Simmons. The off-ball players were pressing out a little bit, not letting Simmons have an open look, but great ride again by Albany.
Albany has just taken it to San Diego in all of the margin areas.
They have, and you know, I'd say they're beating San Diego in just about every category, whether it's consistent looks on offense, quality defensive possessions, transition, special teams. Albany putting together a complete game here.
Now Simmons racing underneath, stays out of the crease.
Great job by Cameron holding right there. Those dangerous areas of the floor right in the middle. Number 19 in purple does a better job defending that area than most players in the NLL. Exactly what San Diego's defense needed, but Wesley Berg called with the off-ball push, and here comes Albany.
Albany with just over a minute and a half left in the third. Keeping their foot on the gas pedal. Firewolves dominating this game one. Grennan bounces it up high for his second. Look out. The Firewolves have their largest lead of the game.
Boy, and this is just a ridiculous shot by Nathan Grennan. As he's coming on the floor, he does a big sweeping motion from the midboards all the way over the top. And those bounce shots are so difficult. You see how close the ball hit the turf, but it explodes off of that turf to where you think it might be kind of going underneath your armpit or down to the left. But the pop that the ball has coming off of the floor sent it right into that top right corner. Ridiculous shot by Grennan.
What's interesting tonight is San Diego's defense is predicated on directing the offense where they would like to go. Albany has dictated where the ball is going at every point in this game. How does that happen? They've just completely broken San Diego's defensive scheme.
One, I'll give credit because every single time they come down, they're throwing a new look. Two-man game, sweeps over the top, off-ball movement.
And Jameson makes a big save on LeClaire.
You can only take away so much, but what Albany's done a very, very good job of is having a new look every time they have a 5-on-5 offensive possession.
And the shot clock expires on San Diego. Now it'll be Albany ball with 42.8 seconds left in the third. Frustration building for the Seals, and you can see it not just on the floor, but in the building. Albany will go to the 6-on-5 as Jameson trots over to the bench. Delayed penalty. Firewolves have converted 2 of these 6-on-5s into goals tonight. Walker thinking about it, feeds Kurtz, and he whistles it wide of the post. So Albany goes back to the power play.
And you know, kind of going back to San Diego's defense, I feel like they're struggling to identify if they're going to be playing out in pressure or packing it in and protecting the middle of the floor as we go in for the call here.
San Diego penalty number 25, 2 minutes, slashing.
Eli Gobrek sits down, and now Albany goes back to the power play for the final 18 seconds of the third, leading by five and a chance to blow this game open. They could double up San Diego before the end of the third and make this a mountain to climb in the final 15. Walker, Kurtz with space, Kurtz hits the pipe. San Diego bailed out by their little red friends.
Watch out
as Kyle Rubish is tied up with Marshall Paulus. And they're going to send Paulus to the penalty box.
Referee sending him to the box, Paulus pleading his case. A lot of hand movement.
Albany penalty number 8, 2 minutes, roughing.
Well, that wraps the third quarter, 45 minutes down. And Albany dominating game one on the road in the NLL semifinals. 15 minutes separate them from going home with a chance to clinch a spot in the finals on Sunday.
What's up?
Geico covers dead batteries with their easy app and 24/7 help.
You've reached the dead end, monster!
No kidding. Dead batteries are the worst. But no worries. Geico gives me even more coverage and 24/7 help. See?
Wait a second. You're not Frankenstein's monster.
No, that's his cousin Trevor.
Did you try the spooky castle up the road?
Good idea. Thanks. You folks have a great evening.
Whatever you need, from coverage to service, get more with Geico.
When we say it'll be on time, they expect it to be on time.
Turn shipping to your advantage.
Keep those expectations with Reliable Ground Shipping.
Thanks, Brandon.
With USPS Ground Advantage.
Ever since our tournament leader started dipping what appears to be a chicken tender in Hidden Valley Ranch, he's just stopped playing.
To be fair, Bill, it does look zesty.
Hit the ball! Sorry for raising my voice.
Hidden Valley Ranch.
Only serious about flavor.
All flights canceled.
There's places in life you just don't want to be.
Getting a crash and being in a courtroom without us? Well, that's one of those places.
We know how to get you everything you deserve.
At Harding Mazzotti, we think big.
And if those insurance companies want to fight, well, our record speaks for itself.
Standing in the courtroom against us, that's one place they don't want to be.
Start of the fourth quarter, and the Albany Firewolves continuing their unlikely story with an 11-6 lead and a chance to take a 1-0 lead in this best of three series. Look back at history, just 3-15 last year, an 8-game improvement year over year. They started 6-0. At one point, they were 10-2 and then lost 5 in a row before winning their final regular season game and beating Halifax in the quarterfinals a week ago. They are the youngest team in the NLL by average age at 25 years and 11 months. Glenn Clark, the architect of this team as both the head coach and general manager, is 15 minutes away from going home to the Capital Region with a chance to punch their tickets into the NLL Finals.
You gotta say, credit to Coach Clark here, because this young roster is not acting like it. They're playing fantastic.
Baptiste kicked away by Jamison. He hasn't had to make a lot of saves tonight, but he's made all of the important ones.
And just a little pizza party in the corner right there. Good old youth lacrosse ball scrum.
Well, we'll see if in this fourth quarter, San Diego turns a corner and starts winning some of those 50-50 loose balls that Albany has dominated tonight. As we talked in the third quarter, all of the hard work aspects of this game have come up white. But San Diego wins this one and has a chance to set up with a fresh 30-second shot clock.
And I think it starts in their defensive side of the floor. Albany's gotten consistent loose balls off of rebounds. You got to eliminate that, and that can be something to build on.
Playing 4-on-4 for another 35 seconds until Eli Gobrek is released, and San Diego goes to 5-on-4. Marshall Palace also in the box. Stotts up high. Jameson, easy work into the corner as Stotts boxes out Tchaikovsky. Fresh shot clock. Dixon, defended by Nardella. Dixon racing to the middle. Dixon up high, and Jameson another stop. Three consecutive saves to start the fourth for Doug Jameson. And now here comes Albany pushing the pace. It's Kaschuk who throws on the brakes. Gobrek comes out of the box. San Diego goes up a man for the next 12 seconds. And Albany throws it away. Kellen LeClaire comes up with it. LeClaire kicked away Jameson. Four massive saves to start the quarter, and Albany back out of the box is even at 5-on-5.
Great save by Jameson right there, and great save by Austin Stotts to not let the bounce pass go over. We talked about how tricky those bounce shots are, even tougher in one-on-one.
He's got Paulus trapped. Surely this will be reviewed, but Austin Stotts recognized the mismatch and attacked Marshall Palace.
The second time he's lost his helmet and scored in 2 weeks. As we talk about it, it just is inevitable. When Austin Stotts puts his head down, particularly on Palace, who was trapped on defense, he just makes magic happen every time he decides to go full send towards the crease. No difference there as he sneaks it near side. And if you're looking for a fire starter for San Diego to claw their way back into this game, look no further than Austin Stotts.
Still a 4-goal deficit, and it looks like Glenn Clark is going to pass on challenging, so it will stand. And Albany has called for a delay as San Diego award possession. Firewolves were struggling to get the right personnel on the floor. So San Diego now a chance to stack goals as Dobie unable to handle the pass, and Jameson knocks it down to Wagner.
Another pass attempt by San Diego making its way to the net.
And it deflects off Kurtz's stick and out of play. The look was there though. Watkinson had the right idea.
It was, and you know, that's just one of those unfortunate tip off the top of your stick out of play. A rare misstep from Albany, who's been so consistent in finding those opportunities.
Austin Stotts finally scored his first of the night just moments ago. Now feeds Dixon, tried to tuck it near corner. Stotts gets it back, no reset, 7 seconds on the shot clock. Stotts steps right in, up high off Jameson. San Diego retains possession.
Boy, great save by Jameson there. We've seen Austin Stotts nail that shot so many times here at Pechanga Arena. The crowd was almost expecting it. But Jameson stands tall with that left shoulder.
Albany has dominated much of this game thanks to Alex Simmons scoring 5 goals and posting 9 points. But right now their defense trying to hang on to the lead. Wesley Berg scores! Don't let this building wake up, because weird things happen late at night in San Diego.
And this is the textbook two-man execution that you expect from Curtis Dixon and Wesley Berg. Berg finds the space after setting the pick, and when he goes airborne, good things happen. Corrals the low pass, and he is so good at not only taking to the air, but throwing a fake airborne to sneak it back to that near side. Nobody better at that move than Wesley Berg, getting his second of the night. And the momentum back in San Diego's corner.
Still 11:40 left in this fourth quarter, which is a lot of time. A 3-goal deficit can disappear in a hurry, but Albany gets a well-timed win off the faceoff. They've had an answer every time they've needed one tonight, because Alex Simmons and this youthful offense have played like veterans. Sam Firth sweeping, feeds Ty Kurtz. Whips it to Walker. Simmons. Rubish comes out on him. Simmons gets away. Simmons might have hit the post. As it's Goose into the corner, and three seals converge on Walker.
Boy, unbelievable job by Simmons to beat a double team and get a shot off. But let's not forget that that's a great defensive possession by San Diego as another great ride. John Wagner up ahead. Mike Byrne scores! A momentum-killing goal for Albany, and credit John Wagner for making it happen. What a playoff run he's having. Byrne gets the goal, but look at the effort by Wagner stripping Danny Logan before the one-on-none, and Byrne just buries it. I mean, you talk about how Albany's winning in transition and in the gray areas of the floor, and that is a textbook perfect example. I mean, what more can you say about the resilience and how well this young Albany team is playing?
Mike Byrne scored once in 18 games this regular season. That's his first playoff goal, and it's a big one. You could feel the momentum starting to swing to the home team after back-to-back San Diego goals to start the fourth quarter, but Albany goes ahead and cuts loose and takes the win right out of their sails.
And I gotta say, the athleticism from Albany is impressive to say the least. That's probably the fourth or fifth cause turnover in transition, and those are some of the toughest ones to execute on.
Nathan Grennan floating around. His shot deflected by Trey LeClaire. And we're gonna get a penalty against San Diego as Bradley threw Walker into the boards head first.
Gotta say, that's the third penalty, or at least third instance, in which a player has been sent roughly into the boards as Albany's trainer comes out to take a look. But as we go back and watch the replay, you know, that's one of those you initiate contact, and Walker took a couple steps before going into the boards. And we'll go in for the call here.
San Diego penalty number 15, 2 minutes boarding.
It'll be a 2 minute minor penalty against Graydon Bradley. Patrick Merrill with a look of frustration that, you know, he talked this morning about how important discipline would be, and his team frankly has not been very disciplined tonight.
Now there are some gray areas which, you know, you can call it ticky-tacky, but when guys in white are getting thrown into the boards, you just got to clean that up.
When you're trying to make a comeback, you can't afford to play man down for much. 2 for 4 on the power play tonight. Firth playing catch with Kurtz to Simmons. Nearly had his first career sock trip. Patrick Schume helicopters his way out of danger, and San Diego's not going to waste any time. Schume to the cup. Schume attacking. And Stotts recovers as San Diego will kill some time, but likely try and press as Kurtz is caught back on defense. He'll stay on. Stotts twists the pass to Dixon. Shot clock at 5 seconds. Dixon goes right at Colton Watkinson. One hands it on net. Doby retrieves it, unable to get it on cage.
Boy, what an individual effort by Curtis Dixon right there. I don't know how he held on to the ball, but it just goes to show how he's probably the number one draft pick and guys that you want on your shorthanded attacking unit.
And it looks like they're gonna call Ethan Walker for a delay of game. San Diego trying to get off the floor in a hurry at the quick restart.
As a good old-fashioned meeting of the zebras at the watering hole. Gotta figure out what exactly is going on here.
Albany calling on 57, 2 minutes delay.
Delay of game against Ethan Walker as we'll step aside, 8:51 to go. San Diego trying to mount a comeback as Albany looks to steal a 1-0 series lead.
No, I don't think so. Sunday afternoon, it is a semifinal Game 2 doubleheader right here on ESPNU. First at 3 o'clock Eastern, catch the second installment of tonight's game when the Seals travel to Albany. Then directly following at 5:30, the Toronto Rock head to Bandit Land for their Game 2 matchup. Will the Bandits secure their place in the NLL Finals, or will the Rock force a Game 3 back in Rock City? Both games will also stream on ESPN Plus and TSN Plus. Star of the show, Alex Simmons, doesn't look like a rookie on a 5-goal, 9-point night.
And what's impressed me most about him is, you know, coming in as a rookie, you try to do one or two things at a very high level. You kind of have, hey, here's what I'm bringing to the team, but he's bringing everything to the team. Assist, pass, going underneath, shooting from range, beating his man towards the middle of the floor. He's put together a great sampler platter of what he can do.
He has been the best player on the floor tonight, and there are multiple Hall of Famers playing tonight.
And I don't think there's a question or anyone that would argue that.
4-on-4 for 50 seconds after the penalty against Walker. Dixon cutting, Dixon scooping. And Berg retrieves it against the boards. Shot clock does not reset. Stotts face dodges. Berg still has 7 seconds. He's got Kaschuk on him, swims to space. Now Nardella defends, penalty away from the ball. And they're gonna send Curtis Dixon to the penalty box. And you can see the frustration boiling over for San Diego.
And, you know, it just looked like Curtis Dixon was going and trying to set a hard pick. Refs have been calling it tight all night.
San Diego penalty number 71, 2 minutes roughing.
And as we go back to watch Curtis Dixon, he goes to set that pick, and it looks like he might have just gotten his hands up high a little bit. And credit to Albany's defense for not letting that create too much space. But 4-on-3.
Firth, Kurtz, Simmons, Palace. Palace back to Firth. Now up to Kurtz. Firth trying to skip it through. Finds Simmons. Hunting for his sock trick goal. Ball pops behind the net. Schume in a 2-on-1 against Albany. And it comes out white. Braden Bradley is released. So 4-on-4 for a minute of game time before Albany would theoretically head to a power play. Simmons picking his way underneath. And he gets a hey, how you doing from San Diego's defense after crashing in to Chris O'Riglieri. Simmons slow to get up as well.
Yeah. You see the frustration by Graydon Bradley right there, especially with a young goaltender who's in his first semifinals. Anytime you have a diving play. And this game has gotten a little bit chippy. We see the number of penalties just skyrocketing, and here comes some fireworks.
In a game like this, how much does San Diego miss the presence of Brody Merrill?
A good amount, but I gotta say, they're not missing it right now because they're just fired up as another Seals penalty by Graydon Bradley addressing Simmons. And you see the frustration with everybody that's gotten a penalty. They've been pleading to the referees, what are you calling me on? As Wesley Burke comes over and is pointing to the monitor, and here come the chants.
Needless to say, the folks in San Diego are not thrilled with the officiating tonight. Now Kyle Rubish and Marshall Powell is chirping at each other. That has been kind of a back and forth all night.
And as always in a three-game series, as this clock winds down, if San Diego can't claw their way back, they're going to look to set the tone for the matchup Sunday in Albany.
It'll be 4-on-3 for the Firewolves. A whole mess of players in the box. 4-goal lead for the youngest team in the NLL by average age. Firth, big doorstop save by O'Reilly, and Firth stepped in the crease. Rubish with the home run pass, got past Wagner, and Doby couldn't find it. You can smell a little bit of desperation starting to brew.
You can, but you know, if there's a team that's dangerous as they're desperate, San Diego is a team that can claw their way back. But even we see right there, Drew Belgrave go and try and take the head off of Albany. They got to stay composed.
Kurtz to Firth, kicked away. Big save, O'Reilly. He's made a living in these tough spots all season. It hasn't been the number of saves, it's been the difficulty. Firth down to Paulus, feeds up top. Kurtz, shot soaked up by Belgrave and out of play. Stays with Albany. It's a 5-on-3 now as Walker comes out of the box.
And I gotta say, if you're drawing a comeback plan for San Diego, tough to find better momentum than stopping a 5-on-3.
They send Walker back to the box, and he will be released momentarily as John Wagner comes on to play center field. They'll run a 4-on-3 down low. Schumme, Belgrave, Rubish, the three that have the task of trying to stop Albany. And Firth steps in the crease. Seals can kill off one of the penalties. It has just 15 seconds left. Belgrave feeds down to Stotts. He's thinking about going right at Watkinson. Draws the double from Byrne. Trying to swim right through, has his helmet taken off. And Stotts unable to pick it up by Rule after losing his helmet. Is Albany able to collect the loose ball and still have 35 seconds of power play time?
That's the rule we found out last week as he scored a diving shot with his helmet off. As soon as your helmet comes off, you just have to get rid of the ball, whether it's a shot or a pass. So Austin Stotts was well within the rules right there.
As he did not have the ball, couldn't go pick it up. So a 5-on-4 for Albany. Simmons throws a fake. Now Walker back behind the net. Paulus on the dunk. A backbreaker from Marshall Paulus. Widens it back to 5.
We talk about the variety of looks that Albany's thrown at San Diego. Well, this is the first time that they'd have a player behind the net. And look at how much space he has to operate. Almost like they were keeping it in their back pocket the entire game. San Diego's shorthanded unit, Chris O'Reilly, nobody in purple ready for that look right there. And that's what Albany's done so good. If you take away one goal that they scored, you take away that style, they are ready with second, third, and fourth looks just like that.
Baptiste straight to the cup. With that goal, Alex Simmons now has 5 assists on the night and a career-high 10 points. A desperate hour starting to brew for San Diego with just over 5.5 minutes left, trailing by 5.
Great individual effort by Baptiste right there, though. Won the draw, got a shot off, and caused a turnover and set a pick.
Doby lets one go from outside. Jamison, an easy stop. Now Doby has a loose ball pop right to him as a penalty is called against Albany. Wesley Byrd. And it will be the Seals now who go to the extra man.
Boy, and I gotta say, this game has all the ingredients of a little scrum breaking out towards the end. I almost thought we were playing baseball. It was Mark McGwire and Sammy Sosa taking swings at each other inside.
Albany penalty number 20, 2 minutes roughing.
The Sturis will sit down in the box for 2 minutes or less.
And as we go back to watch this replay, I mean, you just see how chippy it's getting. Austin Stotts threw a check that lost the head of his stick, and all of a sudden it just becomes a good old-fashioned, hey, how you doing in there?
San Diego 2-for-6 on the power play tonight. Well behind their pace down the stretch of the season when they were up around 60%. Dane Doby, the defended by Wagner, who's had a huge night. Now Dixon back to Dobie, feeding LeClaire, broken up by Jakowski. Good defense by Albany as this man down unit has been locked in tonight.
And one of the interesting things when you're going against a great goalie
and a bad penalty away from the ball against San Diego, just a little bit of frustration, will be a slash drawn by Jakowski. Eli Gobrecht heading to the penalty box.
San Diego penalty number 25, 2 minutes slashing.
4:29 to go. Albany leading by five, trying to put the finishing touches on a game one win on the road in one of the toughest buildings to win in as a road team. Final 4:29 coming up.
Geico covers dead batteries with their easy app and 24/7 help.
You've reached the dead end, monster!
No kidding. Dead batteries are the worst. But no worries. Geico gives me even more coverage and 24/7 help. See?
Wait a second.
You're not Frankenstein's monster.
No, that's his cousin Trevor.
Did you try the spooky castle up the road?
Good idea. Thanks. You folks have a great evening.
Whatever you need, from coverage to service, get more with Geico.
When we say it'll be on time, they expect it to be on time.
Turn shipping to your advantage.
Keep those expectations with Reliable Ground Shipping.
Thanks, Brandon.
With USPS Ground Advantage.
It's how you keep it going, rain or shine. Kingsford is how you do it.
For a career-high 10 points, just a masterful performance for a guy playing in just his second career playoff game and first semifinal on the road, nonetheless, in one of the most difficult buildings to play in as a road team.
I mean, proving himself in the upper echelon of players, he's put together a complete game, and Albany's offense is just so on the same page, working hard to get Simmons his shots. And boy, does he bury him.
Well, San Diego now showing a pressure look as they recognize time is their enemy as much as the Firewolves are. They trail by five with less than 5 minutes to go. Simmons whipping around. Does he have a sock trick in him? Can't connect with Walker as he goes to get it, but Albany had begun their change, so light on the personnel, but it doesn't matter. Kurtz gets a great look, and O'Reglieri makes a must-have save for San Diego.
Boy, and San Diego's defense just fell asleep right there for a second. Great save by O'Reglieri.
That's been the story. Albany has punished every San Diego mistake and managed to goat San Diego into making more of them. Stotts down to Dobie, back up to Dixon, and Jamison a shoulder save. Joakim the rebound for a quick trip. But a hard ride from LeClaire. He gets it back from Stotts. LeClaire! It's not over yet. Back to a four-goal game.
Boy, and this is what Trey LeClaire brings to the table. We saw him have the caused turnover with the ridiculous effort, and even as he gets his stick held there for a second, realizes that he has a window of opportunity, and as he was making that cut, he's pointing out that his stick is being held, but he's saying, hey, Stotts, give me the ball. I'm going on a cut right down the heart of Albany's defense. An athletic, a heads up, and a high IQ play by Trey LeClaire right there.
4-on-4 for another 22 seconds until Leo Sturis is released, and Albany goes to a power play. Big faceoff between Nardella and Baptiste as Baptiste wins the clamp. Gooses it to himself and can't collect the loose ball at first. Now Baptiste runs to safety in San Diego. 3:20 to go. O'Reglieri starting to make the trot off to the bench. Desperation time for the Seals. Berg with Dixon. Now Riglieri goes back to the bench. They play 4-on-4. Dixon! A hat trick for Curtis Dixon, and a 5-goal deficit has become 3.
And you just see the weapons all over the floor for San Diego. And we even saw an Albany defenseman drop his stick. I think the defense was kind of expecting him to pass it up to Berg. So what does he do? He paints that 5-hole corner above the stick, below the cup, better than anybody. And in no more important of a situation, who can you rely on? Curtis Dixon completing the hat trick here tonight. And watch out, crazier things have happened in this building.
Moves him into a third place tie with Gary Gate for the third most goals in NLL postseason history. Power play now for Albany as Eli Goldbrick remains in the box. And we've got another wrestling match breaking out at center stage.
And gotta say, you know, whether you hate or love these, they're working against San Diego because this started with 3:05. Clock's now, you know, who knows when it's gonna be done.
Well, don't look now, but Baptiste, by keeping this tied up, has worked this penalty all the way down to 12 seconds. Albany's gonna have hardly any power play time.
But watch out, 3-on-2.
Here's Mike Byrne, he scored once, now off to Wagner. And we are back to even strength across the board. So Trevor Baptiste ties up Joe Nardella long enough to neutralize the final 37 seconds of Albany's power play. Just over 2 minutes left. Simmons, or the Kurtz, I should say.
Boy, another huge save by Irigliere. He's standing on his head. We talk about how clutch he is. He's making some huge saves in the fourth.
Dixon back on defense as they recognize the need to have some offensive bodies out there. We'll see if Albany can exploit. Simmons underneath. Denied his sock trick goal. San Diego has Curtis Dixon cherry picking. Dixon gets to the middle. Dixon scores!
Just like you drew it up, a massive save by Irigliere. Curtis Dixon was cherry picking with the last 5 seconds. And even though he didn't get a one-on-none, a one-on-one is good enough for Dixon with that lethal jab step to the middle of the floor, buries it, and we got a whole new ball game.
Curtis Dixon now passes Gary Gate for third all time with his 68th career playoff goal.
2 minutes officials review.
So the goal automatically will be reviewed as it occurred under 2 minutes left to play. If it stands, it pulls San Diego within 2, and Albany now with just a minute and 59 seconds separating them from stealing game 1. It has to be a little bit of an uncomfortable feeling.
It does, and you know, you look at the star power that San Diego has, we can talk about it ad nauseum. They've done a great job limiting them all night, but in classic Seals fashion, over the years, we've seen it mostly in shorthanded situations, but when they need to make plays and every player has the full-on 100% green light, they have the weapons to do some pretty ridiculous things. It just happens to be Curtis Dixon right now, but it could be Stotts, it could be Dobie, it could be Berg as we go in for the call.
After review, the call on the field is confirmed. Good goal.
San Diego with 3 goals in the last minute and 43 seconds to pull back within 2.
And let's not forget, that's a great pass by Eli Gobricht. And that's an impossible one-on-one to stop for Dixon.
Massive face-off now. Albany has dropped 4 into the defensive zone. Baptiste and Nardella wrestling all night in what has been a great matchup. Back to even strength. Now it's Nardella who's happy to take time off the clock, whereas Baptiste was the man milking the clock earlier. Baptiste has it pop out, and San Diego wins it. Cameron Holding has it. Riglieri getting ready to go to the bench. There he makes the break, and San Diego's going to go 6-on-5 with 82 seconds left. Dixon draws Nardella as his defender. Airmails his pass for Dobie. Now Stotts up top. Dobie. Score! return to San Diego, and it's a one-goal game with 67 seconds left. Who else but Dane Doby? Unbelievable deception on this shot. He's been going high all night and finally brings it back down low. This building, San Diego, everybody has come alive here tonight. And Dane Doby looking at his teammates saying, hey, this game ain't over. We got a whole minute and 7 seconds left to create magic.
Four goals in less than 2.5 minutes to trim a 5-goal deficit down to one. They have 67 seconds left to work with. This has to be, if they can complete it, one of the all-time playoff comebacks.
Without question, as we go in for the confirmation here.
The call on the field is confirmed. San Diego goal.
So let me ask you a question.
Hit me.
For the first time tonight, does age and experience matter?
It very well might, especially on the prediction of where these faceoffs are going to be exited to as San Diego wins it.
So here comes the 6-on-5. Origliere sprinting off to the bench. San Diego trying to tie it. It was a 5-goal game with less than 4 minutes left to play. Dixon initiating up top down to Doby. 6-on-5, 45 seconds. Dixon. Oh, and San Diego gives it away. Watkinson can end it. And the dagger from Albany after the loose ball push.
Boy, and look at San Diego's offensive players going after the referee right now, saying, hey, let the boys figure out who's going to win this game. Don't be surprised if there's a misconduct going right there. As Wesley Bird, Curtis Dixon, and all of San Diego getting in on it. But the call was the call, and Albany pressed as Watkinson scores the empty netter and just took the wind out of the sails of everybody here in a game where the referees have had a pretty big impact. That could be the biggest call of them all.
I mean, make no mistake about it, that call gave Albany a goal. Right or wrong, that isn't the question. Did the call have a serious impact? Yes, it absolutely did.
San Diego bench minor, 2 minutes on Sports Alight.
And that's what I was expecting, the penalty. Bench minor. And again, we talk about it in a three-game series, expect there to be some fireworks in the last 38 seconds as San Diego looks to go and set the tone.
San Diego scored 4 goals in less than 2.5 minutes to go from down 14, or the 13 to 8, I should say, to 13 to 12. They win the faceoff, go to a 6-on-5, and a loose ball push turns the ball over as Albany scores what likely is the icing empty net goal.
Although we've seen 2 goals scored in less than 38 seconds for San Diego recently, but it's a little bit tougher when it's a 5-on-5 as Origliere's out of the net.
Yeah, they'll start 5-on-5 with no goaltender. Now Nardella milking the clock against Baptiste as these wrestling matches have turned out to be quite consequential down the stretch.
And yeah, you just want to make an exit if you're Baptiste right now. You know, get that 50-50 chance.
He gets it out to Schume as San Diego calls a timeout with just under 20 seconds left.
Baptiste a little slow to get up right there, and that very well might be exhaustion. But watch out, I'm gonna call it right now. If there's a diving shot, if there's a feed into the middle, it could get ugly.
Patrick Merrill is incensed. And you know, there are several lines of thinking when it comes to moments like that. The two primary being, should officials be making an impact in the closing seconds, or should they swallow a whistle? And it's always a gray area that you really can't navigate gracefully.
Well, and what's interesting is the refs have been calling it tight all night. There's been no shortage of penalties for either team.
They've been true to form, and that was consistent with how they've called the game.
So if, you know, if I'm a player, I'm kind of saying, like, we have the momentum, we have the shooters, we have the hot sticks. The only thing we have to avoid is getting a call, but let's see if San Diego has some more magic left.
Jameson makes the big save. Dixon closing seconds. Albany comes into San Diego and survives to steal game one of the NLL semifinals. A masterful performance by rookie Alex Simmons. 10 points, the second most by a rookie in the playoffs, behind only John Tavares in a 1992 game. Just an incredible performance by Albany, not just dominating for the vast majority, but then when crunch time came, they were up to the task.
They were, and you know, for a vast majority of the game, right up until the last couple minutes, I would say that that was exactly what Albany was looking to do. I mean, you talk about the different aspects of the game, offense, defense, transition, goaltending, you know, loose balls, extra possessions on offense. For 3 3/4, they just flat out won.
Well, Alex Simmons put his name on the map this season with a dominant rookie season and continued that form into tonight. 10 points for Alex Simmons, including 5 goals and 5 assists. Just remarkable work in his second career playoff game. He's down on the floor with Rayne Michaels.
Thanks, Cooper. Alex, what a game for you, but can you just talk about the group effort of this one?
Absolutely. I mean, without Doug Jamieson, you know, we don't win this game. We kept with our composure. We gave a little scare at the end there, but you know, you just got to battle through those things, right? This is playoffs. We knew that we were gonna get their best effort, so we're just happy to come on the winning side of this one, and we can't wait to take it back to Albany.
Yeah, game two, like you said, Sunday. What can you carry over into that one?
Just offensively, the same thing. That was probably one of our best performances we've had all year, so we just want to carry that along. And defensively, you know, other than that last 5 minutes, we want to carry that on as well.
Thanks, Alex. Congrats.
Thanks.
Guys.
Well, Alex Simmons wasn't the only player who made big plays in big moments. Doug Jamieson made a series of incredibly important saves. While San Diego did get a few there at the end, Jamieson didn't make a lot when you look at the volume compared to last week, but did make 27 stops. He's down on the floor with Rayne Michaels.
Thanks, Cooper. Doug, making some huge saves against some future Hall of Famers out there. How are you able to stop them?
That's a great team, some great players. I got lucky a couple times, made some saves. I think we want to clean up the end there a bit. That's not the way we want to finish, but a win's a win.
And what do you want to focus on heading into Sunday?
Just coming out and getting a good start like we did, I think, and build off that. Like I said, defensively, we need some things to clean up, and I got to be a little better, but we'll take it.
And what did you see out of your offensive unit out there tonight?
Yeah, it's huge when they can get us a lead like that, a couple goals, and then we can kind of sit on it. Like I said, we did too much at the end there. But, it's huge when they can score like that.
All right, well, thanks, Doug. Congrats.
No problem.
Guys.
Game one in the books. Nick, quick thoughts before we go.
A complete game by Albany, but let's not forget that to end, San Diego had all the momentum in the world, so they could take some individual performances in the late fourth quarter into Sunday, but what a performance by Albany.
Back Sunday at 3 p.m. Eastern for our producer, Kimberly Booth Higgs, our director, Jeremy Bruner, for our stage director, Mary Bodecker, Rayne Michaels, and Nick Cosello. I'm Cooper Perkins saying thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.
Geico can help when you're locked out with their easy app and 24/7 help.
Dad, you don't have to make this so tough on yourself. Geico can help us get into our locked car. See?
Yeah, but... Let's go!
Clippers have never won a championship.
Jeez! Before we had Geico's great coverage and 24/7 help!
We got a bad boss.
The players loved me.
We literally hate you!
If he comes here, there will be a riot.
I'm your owner.
You're not my owner.
It's my world.
Knows what to expect.
Turn shipping to your advantage.
Keep it simple with clear upfront pricing.
with USPS Ground Advantage.
But isn't a McDouble with extra pickles, a side of fries, and a high C at home?
Sure anymore.
You know we're not actually pirates, right?
Of course we be pirates. Look at me hook.
Hidden Valley Ranch.
Only serious about flavor.
Riley's officially a teenager.
Sorry.
These are high schoolers.
Hello, I'm anxiety.
I'm envy.
That's ennui.
And that's embarrassment.
Oh. We're Riley's new emotions. We're gonna be best friends.
Well. On June 14th.
We will never stop trying to get better. Because when medicine gets better, all of us can get better.